Good evening, everyone, and welcome back. That's right. It's True Sight, the Dota podcast, and we're on episode number 5. It's the 24th of September, and True Sight, of course, is going to be brought to you by FountainDive.com. Go over to FountainDive.com right now to check out all the cool new latest Dota content and hero strategy guides, including Tinker, Pudge, and Kunkka. And, of course, you can catch all of our True Sight Dota cast VODs, rather, all over the place from episode 1 through 4. And also, of course, going to be presented by us over at HighGroundTV. So let's go ahead and lead things off with our normal introductions. I am going to be your host and local mana giver. My name is Dakota KOTLGuy Cox, but joining my group, my normal ragtag duo, let's say, by my side again, you can currently catch him casting anything from the Canada Cup Season 3 to the graveyard shifts for Beyond the Summit, a man whose nipples are so manly that they can start a fire by rubbing two ice cubes together. Mr. Travis Ma Bueno, welcome back, my friend.
That's actually a true statement. Completely 100% true. I have yes. Seen it. My nipples are erect as we are into 6.82. It's coming out pretty soon. I'm very excited for it. It's good to be here again. And as always, pleasure to join you guys. So looking forward to it.
Excellent. Welcome back, my friend. Also back once more, a man who is quickly becoming one of the hardest working and saltiest people I know. Currently producing some hot new game titles, including Gerg Effect 2, Super Gerg Brothers, and Gerg Theft Auto 3. It's Mr. Greg WhatIsHip TV. Welcome back, my friend. How you doing?
I'm doing good, man. I got my fingers crossed right now. I turned off the stream, but Team Gerg is going up against Complexity, and they're in game 2, so I give them my hopes that they carry on my namesake, so I have to buy them jerseys.
And Greg being the mascot of this team, we hope him the best. If you're representing the KOTLGuy out there in chat, please throw him up right now to show your love for the Gerg, his holiness. But also, we have a special guest, as always. It's a man who's been crunching the numbers and doing stats for some of the biggest names in the Dota sphere, including Beyond the Summit, Join Dota, and even us, the biggest of all, HighGroundTV. He's also been recently dabbling with some co-casting and just surprising everyone with the tremendous amount of talent. Our savior almost for tonight's episode coming in at last minute, Mr. Alan Nahaz. Bester, how are you doing, my friend? Thank you so much. Can't thank you enough for coming on. How's it going?
I'm glad to be here. It could be going better. I'm looking through some of these patch changes and, oh boy, but we'll get into that, I'm sure.
Yeah, not a believer.
Trust me, no. Folks. We got a nice episode for you today. As you all already know, we got a big one. It's 6.82. The patch notes have been released. It's active right now in the test client. So I want to lead things off by saying that there has obviously been a lot of videos out there already. Everyone going through the nit-grit of the patch from top to bottom, as big as 5 hours long, breaking everything down with all sorts of Dota pros. So, you know, we want to be able to also bring the content your way, but we don't want to be rambling on forever about it. So we're each going to kind of go through, pick out some of our more favorite things, have a nice open table discussion about it so we can bring what's been happening here. So, I mean, without further ado, gentlemen, if you don't mind, I can lead things off. And one of the biggest changes I think that's hit Dota in a long, long time is the map. It's adjusted. It's been changed around. This is crazy. I've been playing Dota for 8 years, and I've been staring at the same map for that long. And now we actually have to look at something different. This is getting out of control. And, well, one of the biggest things is that I guess Roche's lease has been up, and he's ready to move. He's got 2 blocks down the river, and he's found a new spot. That's going to change things up and make things a little more even, hopefully, for both sides. But we also have a new set of nooks and crannies and paths. We got a new path on the Radiant side shop that goes up to the north on the Radiant off lane. The secret shop has a new path that cuts over. This can allow for, of course, some easy access for the offlaner to move into the secret shop, but also can cause the offlaner to be more susceptible to ganks now. This is a lane that most considered, you know, people were unable to touch the offlane. It was just too safe for him, but now he's got a lot more to worry about here. Guys, I open up the floor here to your thoughts on this new map change. This is pretty crazy here. Greg, I mean, lay it in, man. What's happening here?
The map changes, I think, are... I mean, people have been complaining about this for so long, whether it's warranted or not. I guess you can decide for yourself. I mean, I think the biggest problem they had is that the gameplay differences on the two sides of the map are pretty severe. Like, when you're playing Radiant, your goal is to win the lanes as hard as possible and snowball. Generally, depends who you ask, but the popular consensus is that on Radiant, you try to win the lanes as hard as you can and then snowball. On Dire, you try to win the lanes or at least go even in the lanes and then get one or two pickoffs and then slide into Roshan and use that to sort of get back into it if you're behind or solidify your advantage. But, I mean, my thing is that when you look at, you know, win rates, even a lot of the games we've been watching recently, to me, it doesn't seem like it's that severe of a difference on either side. And I kind of like that there's a small gameplay difference on either side. So Roshan, he had some city living. He moved out of the popular neighborhood. Now he's just taking up the old ancient spot. And I don't know. I mean, I don't know how I feel about the Rosh change. I don't know if it's a big deal. It seems weird to me that they moved him.
There's still gameplay differences, though, on both sides. It's not like, you know, taking Roshan and moving him is going to make... I mean, it makes a big difference. Don't get me wrong. It absolutely does. But I feel like there's also... You still have the differences in the jungle, the differences in lane. You have the Radiant offlane still, which is very, very strong. Unless they change that, too. I don't think they did. I'm pretty sure they didn't change that.
I think they buffed Dire offlane like a teeny bit, but it's pretty similar still.
For the most part, I think that there are still some differences. And... even if you don't think this change is warranted, I think there's a lot of people overreacting to it, which, I mean, I understand, but I also think that it's nice to have any change is good change, in my opinion, when it comes to this game, just because there have been so many people that have been playing this game for so long. And, you know, just, I don't know, as someone who's been playing it for a while, it's just like, it's nice to see this bit of a change here and get into something new and different, because it was getting kind of old for me for a bit, so I don't know.
Yeah, it's going to be a nice breath of fresh air, and it's everything. It's not just like the big obvious things like the Rosh Pit and all these new lanes. Like, even the ward placements are going to be different as far as covering the bottom ruin area, you know, covering the ancient camps is different now. So as far as how in the past, like, the Dire offlane would have easy access to that ancient camp area where they could maybe use Beastmaster, throw the axes. Like, all that stuff's changed dramatically. And even as casters or statsmen, if you will, we're going to be looking at the map in a whole new light here. So, Nahaz, man, what do you think about the map being changed completely?
Well, I don't really think it was necessary, first of all. A lot of the talk about the Dire advantage is just completely not backed up by stats. Probably the most compelling case that I've heard for any kind of Dire advantage overall, and I'm talking about when you don't break out by match time or anything else, just overall win rates, K-Poptosis made a pretty good case to me that that first pick Dire was a little bit overbalanced. And I think I agree with that, although the evidence for that is not overwhelming in the data. To me, the big thing is what Greg says was basically right. That basically, if you're Radiant, the onus is on you to push, because once you get to about that 40-minute mark, that's when the Rosh Pit advantage really comes into play. Okay, and that's when you about 40 minutes and later is when you when you start to see Dire win rates really, really spike up to around that 55% and higher range. Radiant, on the other hand, has historically, and in the recent meta, it's actually been quite pronounced, had the higher win rates between 20 and 40 minutes. And it's really not hard to see why. We've seen it in the recent meta game, certainly to a great degree, that Radiant does have the advantage during the laning phase. They have a farm-friendly jungle. They have the easier offlane. And all else equal, if you see both teams pick kind of equally spaced out lineups, Radiant is going to win the lanes, and a lot of the time they're going to be able to turn that into a win of the game. Now, to counteract that, what you've seen in the recent meta is you've seen Dire pick two or three very, very strong solo laners and pick two supports that are either able to get a lot done roaming or able to get a lot done in an offensive try. And the reason that the offensive try is so important for Dire is very, very simple. If you cut the Dota map up into quadrants, right? Mm-hmm. Almost all of the important objectives are toward the lower right quadrant of the map. And so the onus is on Dire to contest that area of the map really throughout the game, but in particular early on to prevent those Radiant supports from just farming freely in the jungle. I mean, we've all seen, you know, Zion is Wraith King on the Radiant side. We've seen 9-minute Blink Daggers out of Sand Kings routinely on the Radiant side. So I actually think that the asymmetry is fine. I think that teams had adapted to it. The meta had evolved around it. The biggest the biggest problem in that regard that I saw with the meta is the pool of viable offlane heroes had really shrunk over time. And I mean, we had seen Darkseer and a couple others make these minor resurgences, no pun intended, and just get crushed, right? So I do think that some of the other changes, like the runes, are good for that. Yeah. I don't know that you needed to change the map. And this idea that there was some kind of unfair, dire advantage that needed to be balanced is just hogwash to me. I mean, the asymmetry, to me, it adds another layer of strategy to the meta.
It's part of Dota, right? For me, exactly. It's part of Dota. The Radiant is good at one thing. The Dire is good at one thing. You have to pick accordingly for each side.
And it ends games.
Yeah.
I mean, Radiant, especially in this meta, which there are certainly problems with it, but Radiant knows in this game that they are going to have to push and that in most circumstances, they better damn well do it before 40 minutes. Is that a bad thing? I don't think it is.
No, of course not. This is definitely something that a lot of teams are going to might need to consider practicing, just getting a feel for this new map kind of a layout, being able to really take advantage of these new nooks and crannies of pathwork here. So there's definitely going to be a long period of teams trying to adjust on how to work with this map, on where the best, you know, ward spots are going to be and how to really make it work. We've all become so accustomed and comfortable with it for so long that, you know, it's time for change and people are just going to have to learn to adjust. And what I would consider as one of the other big changes here is that rune, like you mentioned. And I know, Greg, this is something that really perked your interest here. Why don't you go ahead and fill us in? What's the deal here? We got a new rune on the field. What's that all about?
The new rune, the Bounty rune, gives you a set amount of gold and XP plus an additional amount per minute. So the later in the game, the better the rune is. But the big thing is that it still fills your bottle normally. So there's a couple things I really like about this. For mid lane, it makes bottle crowing not necessarily worse, but a lot less necessary with these two runes. The problem is that supports now are going to be much more likely to get a bottle, especially roaming supports. If you think about like roaming Potom, roaming Earthshaker.
Usually got a bottle.
Yeah, Wisp got a bottle anyway. And all of those things, being able to roam around the map and then still fill your bottle every 2 minutes without taking away the rune from your mid player is a pretty big deal. And then the other thing I like about this is it makes map control a much bigger deal in the earlier parts of the game beyond just like smoke ganks, you know, like, you know, because smoke ganks, there's not really anything you can do about them anyway. It doesn't really matter if you have vision on the map because you can't see them anyway. But having these runes spawn every 2 minutes, if one team gets both runes every 2 minutes, I bet the win percentage for that team is going to be like through the roof. That's a huge advantage, especially because you're going to have a roaming hero who has access to way more health, way more mana. And I think it's just a really interesting change that I don't know if it was, I think it was probably needed, honestly, just because of how mid lane has gotten. And I mean, I guess you guys can say your opinion on this as well, but the lowering of XP from creep denies, I think, is also a pretty big deal for the mid lane. Now, if you deny one creep from the first wave, they don't hit level 2, which is a pretty huge deal. And something that I'm really happy to see come back, because that was a change that was made a couple of patches ago. And then mid lane sort of got away less from CSing and more about, you know, nuking, bottle crowing, pushing a little bit. You know, heroes like Quap fell off quite a bit. They still occasionally see play. And I think maybe we are going to get a little bit more lane-winning heroes back in mid to sort of accommodate for that as well. So I'm looking forward to that. I'm kind of sick of these farmy mids, and I'm ready for some tempo controllers.
Yeah, of course. And, you know, it's crazy to think, because one thing I think about the bat, when you think of how there's going to be two runes every time, and you talk about how maybe one team, if they get a hold of both of them, more often than not, it gives them such a big advantage. And the two heroes that popped up is the two heroes that were untouched this patch, Tiny and Wisp, which was a dual lane that was ran in the mid. Imagine them splitting up, grabbing both runes, controlling the whole scene here. But I would imagine overall, all lanes might look to participate more in getting a hold of these runes and contesting. Yeah. So we're going to see a lot more action off the bat, which as casters, as statsmen, I love it. And I cannot wait to see it.
There's going to be like fights over that zero rune, I think.
Oh, big
much
time.
More than usual.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. And then considering when you have your supports now picking up bottles, looking to grab them for themselves, they could share these bottles when they go back to the lane. This is just like a whole new world. I mean, Maut, did you have any opinions? I mean, you look like a rune man.
I mean, I think it's a good change. People were kind of wondering when the next, you know, rune would be implemented or something along those lines. And it's a bit different, obviously, than what people were expecting. But I think it's certainly a good idea. The what it actually gives you is pretty negligible. You know, later on down, you know, the road, it's essentially something to fill your bottle more than anything, I think. Although it's good early on, I think, for the most part, for some supports, it's really like It's not that much. I think when you look at it, it's just.
I mean, it's like a creep.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's a pretty big deal. But I mean,
for support, a creep is a pretty big deal.
Yeah, exactly. If you're a support and you're not getting that much experience anyways, like if you're a Roman Murano, which we talked about, like it's actually kind of important early on in the game, but it's more important than, again, it's really about filling your bottle and making sure you do have, you know, bottle control and making sure you don't have to crow like crazy, which is, that's a whole other issue. But I think, yeah, like you said, we'll probably see more fights around the runes, and it certainly helps out your offlaner or your supports just to roam in. And I think it's a good idea. It's a good implementation. We'll have to wait and see how it actually works out. But
the one thing I wonder is, like, does adding this rune in, I mean, I think it does. How much does it expand the offlane hero pool? Because now offlaners can even get bottles and work to
get
those.
You can still get punished, though, pretty hard.
Of course, you can still get punished. But, I mean, I think it definitely helps a little bit. Because not only was it, like, maybe you don't get the rune, but if you're an offlaner and you're taking that rune, your mid player can't get it, then that's like a pretty big detriment for some mids, you know? Like, a double damage rune is just like a lane winner, especially early. Even illusion runes are pretty good early for those mids. So, I don't know. I mean, I think something we should talk about going along with this is the change to courier speeds. Because this is a big thing towards Bottle Crow as well. I can't find the exact change on here. One second.
I did also want to ask Nahaz, because he had a moment to opinion. I mean, you're a stats man yourself, right? I would imagine statistically two runes are better than one, would you say?
So I think that on balance, it's probably a pretty good change. I don't know that it was really necessary. I think the best thing that it does is as we've already talked about, potentially increases the viable pool of offlaners as well as potentially junglers. Right. Don't forget, especially on the Radiant side, junglers can really benefit from access to that rune as well as rotating supports. I think you're 100% right that roaming Mirana, even bottle first, potentially is potentially viable now. I don't know. I think there might have been other ways to do it, but I'm okay with this change. I don't really. There are enough changes in this patch, which I do have strong opinions about, that this one is kind of in the middle for me.
Yeah. There's a whole lot still to cover, of course, and as we just start to crack the shell of this patch. It's everything. Like, just when you think you've got some stuff covered, there's little things that just have changed. Like, you were talking about the courier speed. I know they adjusted, like, just the base move is so much higher, but the burst speed is so much less than it happens, and even some fun little stuff as far as the courier morphing. So you can actually see who's going to feed the courier when it dies. So you can see, oh, look, it was a Greevil. Thanks, Maut, for feeding the courier.
Whoa. Hold on.
I love that stuff. That's fun.
Can we speak about the courier here?
Go ahead.
Sure.
So base movement speed from 350 to 430. I mean, this is whatever. That's fine. The flying courier is a little bit faster. Big things, the courier speed cooldown is now 90 seconds, and burst is now 4 seconds instead of 20. And as the burst is a little bit faster, but the end result of this is that bottle crowing is much worse now, because you rely on speed to bring the bottle back to base, because if not, it's just slow as hell. So this, combined with the other runes, I think should put bottle crowing down a little bit. I guess we'll have to see how slow the courier is with a bottle without speed now. But bottle crying, I think, is definitely a lot worse now because of this change.
Well, it's interesting to me that melee heroes can actually, like, get a courier kill now from a lot lower level. So what was... Remind me, guys, do you guys remember what's the empty bottle slow?
I can't even...
It's a lot.
It's like 30. It's like 30%, isn't it?
It might even be more than that.
So
I'll look for you.
The point's gonna be if you do the math, and if you take 430 movement speed, right, most heroes, even with upgraded boots, aren't gonna be catching 430 movement speed courier, but 430 movement speed minus 30% is well within the speed range where most heroes are gonna be able to catch up to it. So what this does is it kind of makes bottle crowing a lot more risky, which I think is a good thing.
Even melee heroes hit it harder now, too. That was another little small tweak. Melee heroes, if they get a hold of that courier somehow, they do like 50% more damage. I'm not a death man personally, know my math, but I would imagine that the two hits and maybe the career goes down or something. So, you know, that's also something to be, you got to be more careful, more risky with you decide to get that coming in. So I don't know. I mean, obviously these pro players would know better than me and how they, nurture their couriers and how they want to risk it around. And I'm just throwing the courier in the lane like carelessly. And next thing you know, it dies and everyone's going to be blaming me for it. But yeah. You know, we'll have to see. It's a big deal. It's just another big deal.
It is 30%, so you were right.
Yeah, good call there, sir.
4:30.
Mott. The man laying back there in the dark right now of this patch right now. What do you think is something that's really a shell shocker as far as the patch goes? What's another?
It's easily the tower gold change. I think that the tower bounty is actually huge. It's like
can we reclassify that to tower changes in general?
Yes, tower changes in general. That's also another thing is like I can understand the change to the bounties, but the glyph thing was like I don't really know about that. That seems a little ridiculous for you to do that. I don't know if you really needed to change the whole glyph thing. It's just kind of like, all right, guys, listen, it's like 20 minutes, don't rush in StarCraft. All right, ready, go. Like, that's what it is to me. It's like, there's really no reason to implement that change. And I said earlier, you know, sometimes the changes go better.
Wait, you don't think there's a reason for that?
I mean, there is
a
reason
for that.
But there's a
really good
reason.
Did you watch the finals of the international? Are you even there?
But there's not a reason to change both the gold bounties. Shut up, Greg. Jesus. There's not a reason to change the gold bounty and the glyph change. There's no reason to change both of them, I think. I don't really know if you need to change the tier one tower thing, and especially with how the game's going to get played now. I don't know if there's a reason for both of those changes to be implemented, at least in the same patch. Just like, hold on a second. We haven't seen how the first thing works out yet before we implement the second thing. This seems a little too hasty to me.
No, that's right, okay? I think that
you're
the...
You're fucking
the,
wrong, Mott.
Oh, shut up,
Greg.
Jesus.
Dude, what the... the reduction in gold bounties was very logical and important. The glyph thing seemed like overkill and came out of left field. I mean, we can talk about some of the gold issues in a minute because that's going to be my big thing to bring up. But I don't know why they would stack those two changes on top of one another. But something along those lines needed to be done.
Yeah, definitely. Yes. Something. I mean, it really is. Striking a chord with a lot of the teams, especially on the eastern side of Dota, who love their death ball. They love to get one tower, and they're like, hey, guys, we got one tower.
Right.
We still got our exorcism to use or whatever. Let's just go on and get the next one. Now that is just not nearly as obtainable. So it just really changes the meta once again, which, hey, I welcome. You know, I want to see a whole different style of Dota, so I'm really excited about it. But, you know, let's move on. I mean, as far as big changes, now as you're talking about, like, oh, this is a big, but there's so much more. This is okay, but there's other stuff like of this patch, man. What do you think then? What's another big one that strikes a chord with you? That what you went through the patch notes, you're looking through, and you saw one, you're like, holy shit, are you kidding me right now?
Well, I mean, so are you guys ready for me to like drop the bomb here? Because there's one change in this patch for me that is just. I mean, it's almost to the point where you have to address it before anything else is even worth thinking about. And it's the gold bounty change and the XP bounty change. And I think it might ruin the game at the pro level anyway. I really do. I think the 6.82 metagame because of it is going to be awful. I think that a lot of the old 4-protect-1, 60-minute game farm fests are going to make what comes after this look like your favorite 80s action movie. And here, look, so I wasn't convinced that this was going to be that bad until I ran the numbers today. And so there's, if you're interested, there's a thread I posted on Reddit called something like EE's Bounty. And what prompted it was I was listening to C9 versus Fnatic today. And Bulba made a comment, you know, sometime during the mid game, he made a comment. He said, oh, offhandedly, by the way, you know, if they killed EE here, it would be worth like 1,000 gold. And I was like, yeah, you know, that's probably right. I should probably go check that. And so I actually took the numbers from the current game state and plugged them into the new bounty calculation. And it turns out, I actually, if you look down in the thread, the last comment I posted, I actually went back into the replay and I froze the game at 16 minutes and took the full distribution of net worth because the new kill bounties depend on the gap in team net worths as a percentage of the sum of the two teams' net worths. And in stomps, that's going to be about 30%. So that's Basekip and I were talking about this morning, going back and forth. And we kind of settled on that number that if you look at most really stompy games, okay, the gap is about 30% of the sum. And so that's fine. But the biggest thing is, on top of that, the kill bounty is dependent upon the net worth of the player that got killed. And so if you looked at this game, it was 16 minutes exactly. And EE had right around a 10K net worth. He had about a 9,500 net worth. And Cloud9's total team net worth was about 32K. And Fnatic's was about 15K. And there's a scene, even I had a screenshot on it. There's a scene of Trixie's Nature's Prophet, like kind of off to the side. EE's Lycan is fighting Boogie's Tidehunter, and Trixie's Nature's Prophet is off to the side, and he's kind of about to go in and smack Lycan in the face. And I did the math, and it turns out that if Boogie gets away and Trixie gets a solo kill on Lycan at that point, the gold bounty is at least 1,650 gold. Where before it would have been 269. Oh. And on top of that, although the old killstreak gold still was reduced a little bit, it still applies on top of that bounty. So at that point in the game, EE had been farming and split pushing. So he's actually 0-1. So there was no killstreak. But if EE had been beyond godlike at that point, that killstreak bonus applies on top of the new bounty, and the bounty becomes almost 2,500 gold at 16 minutes into the game. Okay? Yeah. That's almost 20%, and this is a stomp. I mean, this is a stomp where C9 had over double the net worth of Fnatic as a team, and that's almost 20% of that net worth lead that's gone with one kill. And so here's the other thing I did for fun. I said, okay, even if you factor in that kill closes the gap a little bit, what would happen on top of that if Trixie's Nature's Prophet walked into the mid lane and killed Fada's Brewmaster, who at that point had a 7.5K net worth? It turns out that if you assume that Fada's Brewmaster was around unstoppable in a kill streak, that Trixie, who at that point in the game had only 4K net worth on his Nature's Prophet, he had two Null Talismans, Boots of Speed, and he had a Robe of the Magi and a Chainmail going toward his Blade Mail. So he's going that new Nature's Prophet build.
Oh, God.
It turns out that's all he had. He was like sixth or seventh in the net worth rankings at 16 minutes into the game. Only 4K net worth compared to E's 9.5K and Fada's 7.5K on his Brew. It turns out that those two kills, Trixie can walk to the shop, sell off his Chainmail, and buy a full Orchid from two kills. Wow. From two kills. And in the process, his net worth is now second only to Lycan's. He's behind only just 2K on Lycan. And this is a game that started off 32K net worth to 15K. And here's the thing, okay? Here's the thing. If we've learned, I'm an economist by trade. A lot of you guys will know this already, okay?
I didn't think so, but go ahead.
If we've learned one thing in modern economics, it's that people respond to incentives. And that often, to understand the way people are going to respond, you have to think like one step out. You have to think one step beyond. So the natural question that I get asked, you know, when I am dumb enough to post this kind of stuff on Reddit, all right, the natural question that I get asked is, well, how is it a bad thing that the team that's behind can now come back? Isn't that good? Doesn't that, you know, prevent some of these stomps? I mean, this is one of the big problems with Dota. We were talking about this before the intro to the show, that, you know, one of the biggest single barriers that we have, especially for new people, and hell, let's be honest, even for all of us playing the game, is that there are just way too many games you play in that are basically over at 15 minutes and they last another 15. And that last 15 minutes are just like being horsewhipped. I mean, it's just so unbelievably painful. Mm-hmm. Understood. Guys, get it. Okay. But think about how, in response, the pro teams that have leads are going to do things differently. Okay. If you have that kind of a lead at 16 minutes, it's a stomp. We want you to end the freaking game. And now, basically, I really do think a lot of teams are going to say, you know what? We have that kind of lead at 15 minutes. We are risking, this is Nature's Prophet we're talking about. We are risking feeding Nature's Prophet a full orchid off of two kills. Is that a risk you can justify taking if you want to win the game?
I think for the first couple of games, at the very least, people might not understand that, and they'll see how it plays out, and they'll play that like they've always played. But once people start realizing that they're going to give away all of this kind of money, then we'll probably see a shift in their thinking. We'll probably see say, let's play a bit more passively. You know, let's take this a bit slower. Let's, you know, just we'll spread out. We'll, you know, make
how
sure our pushes are good.
How long do you think it takes EG to figure this out?
Seriously,
EG hasn't figured out now.
Yeah, I guarantee they know.
Well, I mean, but on the other hand, that there has been a couple changes that do sort of, I mean, the biggest one I'm thinking of that sort of deal with this is reducing Aegis timer again. Aegis is only 5 minutes now.
Yes, exactly. Yeah.
So there are things that sort of counterbalance this. But I'm worried about the situation you're talking about when it's 20 minutes into the game, someone is getting completely railed. They get like 3 kills in a row, and the game is not even at that point, but it's completely winnable for the other team, you know? And then we have a 50-minute comeback or whatever. Which is, I mean, it's epic, but it's not going to be epic if it's every fucking game.
And it is going to be. And here's the thing. So the natural, the most upvoted comment in that Reddit thread, and I'm going to try not to flame this guy because it's a reasonable comment. But again, you have to think a little bit beyond, okay?
Yeah.
So the most upvoted comment in the Reddit thread was basically some guy that posted and said, look, you know, this is fine, but it's an extreme example with a lot of these new mechanics that we're talking about in 6.82, like the reduction in tower bounties, the gold gaps aren't going to be that big. And that's absolutely right. Okay. And this is part of why I was very much in favor with the reduction in tower bounties. If you look at gold leads and how they've behaved over the last about 6 months, okay, 3 and 5K gold leads at the 10 and 15 minute mark, they are so much more common now. They're over twice as common now as they used to be just going back to 6.80. And that's bad, okay? There are a lot more games where these huge gold leads are being amassed earlier, and it's because of the push meta. Of course, we all know that. We want to do something to counteract that. And so I'm totally in favor of that. But I don't know. I'll put this question to the three of you because to me, as I've been casting a lot of games recently anyway, it seemed to me that a lot of games recently are rubber bandy as it is between about the 10 and 25 minute mark.
Yeah.
This is going to blow that out of proportion. And to the guy that posted, well, gold leads are going to be smaller. We're not talking about a couple hundred gold. We are talking about an order of magnitude. We're talking about gold leads increasing, gold bounties for kills increasing by as much as 10 times. Okay, fine. Cut that gold lead in half. Fine. That's still 5 times the bounty for a kill. That's still you feed the Crystal Maiden a free set of drums with a kill.
Yeah.
It's just, it's too much. It is going to induce a ridiculous degree of passivity in the pro meta. It's something I desperately hope doesn't happen because I think it will utterly ruin the pro meta for at least like a month or two. But again, that's just me. I hope I'm wrong. I'm a little bit upset about this. I hope I'm overreacting.
Yeah. Well, no, I'm glad you took the reins on this one. That's for sure.
I mean, I think when you look at this change, you know, if it was, again, it comes down to if it was this change by itself or that change by itself or that change by itself, it probably would have done the job of what we were hoping to do. But with all these changes that happened at once, it's very possible that we're in a situation where a team gets a 15K XP lead or gold lead or whatever, and they just split push one hero at a time for like 45 minutes till they have like a 50K lead. Like the games that I'm thinking about are like how sometimes it's actually impossible to like push into. A lot of the Chinese teams have unbelievable base defense, right? And a lot of teams go by the sort of theory that you push into a team's base when you have a 20K gold lead. The problem with this now is like, it's just not safe to do that. Because if you have a 20K gold lead and 3 of your heroes die while you're pushing up the base, then all of their heroes are going to have a major item now.
Yep.
So, yep, I mean, exactly. I don't know. I'm really kind of torn about it. I mean, I think on the one hand, the death ball 14 minute GG is not exactly a fun kind of Dota to watch.
Agreed.
But neither is, and coming from very, very personal experience, it seems like I always cast the games that are over 60 minutes. Like, it is brutal to have those games. And if those happen on a regular basis, people are going to hate watching Pro Dota. Because it's not, like, it's exciting when they're like, oh, there's a big comeback. But when it's every game like that, it's just going to be like, it's going to be wearing. Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, I mean, and not to stay on this too much, we can get off this topic, guys, because I know people will be interested in other things. But again, you talk about the late game, right? Late game team fights, even without the big gold swings, because people can always say, well, okay, if you wait till the late game to push, then it's going to be even riskier. Okay, but here's the thing. Late game team fights are going to be risky anyway because of the big respawn timers. Okay, and because of buyback cooldown, right? Late game team fights in Dota, since I've been watching the game now for you know over 3 years, late game team fights have always been a tightrope walk, even for teams with a big lead. And the problem is, we're not just talking about all fights becoming riskier. We're talking about mid game team fights are now relatively that much riskier compared to late game team fights. And so the incentive that the good teams are going to pick up on, I'm convinced almost immediately, is going to be you take everything to the late game, you get as big a gold lead as you can, and that's when you push.
Yep. Now, gentlemen, we do have to, you know, remember this is still in the test client. There could be adjustments to be made. You know, fair enough. These beta testers and now test client, they haven't had the opportunity to make in these kind of situations that we've seen in these big fights. They haven't had the pleasure of working with these big teams and coming down to the nitty-gritty epic wire, but they're hearing all this information. They're going to have a feel-out process, and numbers could be tweaked. But like also Greg said, this is a wealth of changes that could end up counterbalancing each other, and we'll just kind of have to see how it goes. And, you know, we could get all excited about something. They could just go, you know what, never mind, we'll just cut it all in half and, you know, switch it right there, and then we're just getting worked up over nothing. But absolutely, for a guy who's so loves his numbers so much, I can see where it's all coming from, and I definitely appreciate your passion about it, of course. But yeah, we will move on, as I now, hearing all that, can't agree that this is going to be one of the biggest things to come in a lot of these games. So we'll have to see. But let's step away a little bit from the general, and we got a lot of hero changes here. And I want to pick out one of them. You know, it's no big deal. I'm not going to be too biased, but I do believe KOTL recently received a change. That's right, folks.
We all knew it was coming.
I mean, listen, I hate to tell you this, but I still don't think this hero is viable in competitive Dota.
I know. Close. Come on, Maut. Please, let me have something.
I'm just telling you, man, like, they needed to, like, buff his Illuminator. So they needed to make him not ass, and he's still ass right now.
Well,
like,
listen, from a guy I'm who sorry, knows dude. KOTL, let me tell you that this is still a step in the right direction. Now, the value point in mana leak becomes that much more important. The mana drain, if you didn't know, used to be at max level would be 5, an interval of 5. But now that's right off the bat at level 1. Plus, it already has a wealth of other stuff, you know, benefits as it is. So you get that value point in the mana leak early. You might have to be pretty close to get it off, but you're going to be seeing a lot of low-level enemies lose all of their mana instantly trying to just run away simply from a fight. So I like the change a lot, and, you know, I'm curious. And plus, another big change was the blinding light. The blast now blows them back nearly double. So imagine you have a team fighting in the Roche Pit, and you run on in and just blast them all out of the Roche Pit, and they're up on the cliff, they're up in the trees, they're all disoriented, they know what the hell's going on. So, you know, I mean, I know it's not the biggest, best hero change.
I thought you'd start with that, actually. That
but
should be
I had
the
to start with it.
Change.
Look at my name! I had
no,
to
no, no,
start
no.
with
I thought you. What I mean is, I thought you would start with the blinding light change, even ahead of the Monolith, because the blinding light change, to me, is actually more significant throughout the game.
Oh, yeah. But, it's big. It's big.
I don't think any of these other changes really do anything, to be honest.
All right,
we'll
enough.
See about that.
The blinding light one is like, oh no, there's like a corner case where it matters.
The crusher of dreams. Okay, yeah, sure.
Well, your other hero got a big buff.
Oh yes, Earth Spirit. This is a real buff, though. We're going to talk
this
about
is
my
a real
favorite.
Buff. It is
Earth Spirit true. Has quickly become one of my favorite heroes before this patch. I've been testing and working. I drilled him in bot games and pub play here and there, and I've really had a fantastic time playing with him. You know, I didn't enjoy him when he was in his true OP form, when he would do double stuns, but now things get interesting. One of the biggest complaints I had was the targeting system with the stones. It didn't seem proper. It wasn't working right. And now they have a way where it's more priority towards actually kicking the stones. Because even if one of your allies just kind of derps his way on top of your stone, you're kicking him out of the way. You're kicking him into the enemies. And you're just everyone's pissed off at you. And it's just a terrible time. But now the priority is going to be actually with the stones, which I love. And also, an Agnum Scepter
upgrade. Dude, this
Agnum
upgrade is real.
Where did this come from? This is ridiculous. You could turn an enemy or an ally into a stone and use them as so for 3 seconds. And you can also kick them hell out of the game nearly with like 2,000 range. Someone already posted a video demonstration of a boy jumping in, getting a chrono off, and Earth Spirit just strolls up, turns them into a stone, and throws them out of the battle into the other side of the map. It was ridiculous. So as a Earth Spirit player who can frequently run into an opportunity where you just need that one more stone just to, you know, really get the kill, I would be happy to look over to my local Crystal Maiden, turn her into a stone kicker for it, and just get the job done. So I love it. It's probably going to be an item I'm definitely going to experiment with. You know, obviously I'm still a little sad that he's not going to be involved in Captain's Mode, which I understand. He's got a real interesting ceiling of potential to work with and can get a bit obnoxious and just, you know, overall great hero. I don't know. Have any of you guys really had the opportunity to play much of Earth Spirit? I know he's kind of a niche hero with some people, but I love this change. I know a lot of pro players in a lot of these videos haven't really talked about him too much, but I am excited about it.
Dude, for me, the coolest thing is there's another video, which hopefully Sam will show, that has an invoker getting kicked into the fountain from the tier 3.
Oh my God.
Because the range on kick is like just outrageous, right?
Yeah. So it's like two. Yeah.
He kicks them from the tier 3 into the fountain.
You can pull them like 2,000 range, and then if you have like a blink dagger, you blink and kick them even further. It's fun.
This is already a hero that I've heard pro players refer to as like, if you're really, really good, you can just stomp pubs with him. So
it's no surprise you get to the mid game and you're repping like an 8-1 record and you're just setting the stage. And, you know, the problem, but then again, it gets scary. We were talking about the number crunch. This is one of those heroes that can build up a big bounty real quickly. And now you take him out and you throw the game over. So that's where we're talking about counterbalance here, folks, with a lot of these games. So just one of those heroes I love. I love that's got to change, and I'm really looking forward to using. The last hero that I personally want to bring up that I think is one of the scariest heroes that got to change and is still in Captain's Mode is Lone Druid. Lone Druid's bear is not a dumbass anymore, folks. He's got a mana pool to work with, and he ain't afraid to use it. We're talking Mask of Madness use. If you were afraid of getting rooted before, he is going to beat the hell out of you with it. Like, some people, even pub players, use it. Double Necro Book?
I'm more worried about Necros.
Double Necro Book is stupid.
I'm worried about
Dagon.
Yeah, like
somewhere out there, an Admiral Boroldog is jerking off somewhere. I'm just gonna say this is out of control.
Oh,
crazy!
The fapping intensifies, man. No, he's totally right. I mean,
it's crazy. I that's something that is going. I would not be surprised if it becomes first ban, first pick material, especially if you have an avid Lone Druid player on your team. I mean, do you guys agree?
I think it's a pretty big change. I think he'll be much more pickable than he is now. Right now, he's like very corner case, but I think it's a pretty, I don't know. I think it's a pretty good change. He's needed it, like Lone Druid. He also has this additional Bug Fist, which makes him a lot easier to play with the Hand of Midas change. I don't know. I mean, I think it seems like it's pretty good, and I think there's going to be some ways that this can be abused pretty easily, and it might be a situation where there's a couple items that just get banned from using on the bear, you know? So, or like, you know, cooldown sync up or something. Yeah, I mean, it's not a good, you know, that's not a good solution, but
I believe the bear can also place wards now, too. Which is, that's a free roaming, just ward put down. That's what they were talking about in one of the other
I believe do
you could play, that's a free, you just send them anywhere you want, get the free carefree ward put down without worrying about too much threat. It's a lot. When you really think about it, it's like, holy crap, it's like two heroes now involved. It's crazy. And I'm really, by the same time, I'm excited. I'm really looking forward. This is going to really flex the micro skills for a lot of players and really being able to adapt and move it all around. And
Medic Bear is a real thing now.
But don't you go back to what Greg said about, you're talking about the offlane role being really substantively changed between some of the new map angles. And we really haven't even talked about the Radiant offlane all that much detail. Between the new map angles and the rune availability, you're going to see a lot of change to offlaners, and then you're rebalancing a very prominent, or what used to be a very prominent offlane hero at the same time. And it's just, you worry that there are going to be these very exploitable interactions between the two, but maybe I'm just old. F it. I'll drink more.
So we'll have to see how it expands there. Those are just a few of the select heroes that I really was getting percolated over. But Greg, what about some of the heroes that you're getting excited over for this patch, huh?
Well, there's one that I want to hear your guys' opinion on. Okay. Lycan. It has some interesting changes. Shapeshift now does not give the 1.5 BAT. The cooldown is a little bit higher, and the shapeshift speed is faster. But the big thing now is that shapeshift has a 1.5 second transformation time. And there's a couple things I'm curious about your opinion about now, the viability of the hero compared to where he is now. And then also, I don't know the answer to this question, but is this transformation the same as like a lone druid one where you can dodge?
That's what I was going to ask.
Can you dodge damage with it? Because if you can, then it's not bad. I mean, it's still bad, but worse than it is now. But
that's in theory, if anybody in chat knows, right? If anybody's been in the test client, maybe somebody in chat can answer this. But that's going to be the big thing: is it going to be is it going to give invincibility frames? Because if it does, it's not that bad. If it's still like
bad, but it's way better than
if it's like Spiritbreaker's ult, where he just kind of stands there going moo, and anybody with half a brain can stun him.
Yeah. Yeah. Or TP's in. I mean, you're talking normally times when Lycan's side pushing a lane and you're like, well, we got to get there and address it. Now you TP in and you have time to actually catch up with him and take him out. Now, given he has the time to shift, you didn't mention, he is fast as hell now. Holy shit. 650 sure. move speed. If he does get that shift off, you're not going to see him anytime soon. He's going to blaze the hell out of there
fucking
and go away.
Car,
so.
Man.
Yeah, it's quite ridiculous. So, and his wolves are still very nice. So it's really hard to say.
Good.
I think he'll still be like a corner. I think he'll still be pickable in the right scenario, but. Yeah. I think now he's pushed out of the.
I'm not sure.
A little more situational.
Top tier pick, honestly. I think he's still a hero.
I don't know. I think the shapeshift nerf is a pretty big deal because when you like watch, like,
we don't know how it's
going to
work.
Fight, well, Charlie is saying that you can dodge damage with it.
But
that's pretty fucking good.
The length of the invulnerability frames as a fraction of 1.5 seconds is really what this is all about. Yeah. Like if you are invulnerable for the full for like 1 second out of that 1.5,
that's pretty.
It's not a big deal, and in fact, it's a buff. But I doubt
that. You still get like hexed and stuff, you know.
Yeah, yeah.
I don't know, because in my mind, the way I see this playing out, and the reason I think it's like a big nerf for Lycan is, let's say you see Lycan in a team fight. At the end of the team fight, he tries to like abandon ship, and he just can't. You know, he's just stuck. Unless all the CDs are down for all the stunts and everything. Because you can't just slam the R button and run out. So, I don't know. I mean, I think as like a split-pushing hero, he's still completely fine. But as, you know, sort of the all-utility, like, can do everything, team fight with tons of damage, get out easily, you know, he won't be as good. But he'll still be, I think, a very powerful split-pushing tool. Because when it comes down to it, the split-pushing is good because of Hal, because of the wolves, right? So
yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. So we'll see. Yeah, it does become just a touch more situational if teams want to go more push heavy, more split push heavy. You know, it might not be the immediate ban we come to expect, but we'll have to see. With everything else and all the heroes being tweaked as it is, it's really a gamble for now to say who's going to be that primary first ban, first pick. Maut, come on. There's got to be a hero in this patch that you're just like, oh, yeah, I'm ready for this.
There's two heroes in particular I want to talk about. I don't want to stick too long on them because we could spend days on this patch, but I don't know until the actual, you know, patch comes out. We have no idea how it's gonna be, even in pubs. So for me, I think the first, well, one of the very big changes is that for Chaos Knight, they increased the Phantasm duration to 34 seconds. And this is more of a pub kind of thing because if you ever played a pub against a CK and you just let them farm for like 40 minutes, CK is an awful hero early on in the game. He's ass. He's shit. He's really bad. But if you let him get to level 16 and get him some decent items, all of a sudden a 34-second Phantasm illusion duration is actually kind of retarded if you have no real way to clear out the illusions. Like, in the pro scene, it doesn't matter that much. It's not that big of a deal because most people aren't going to pick a CK because he's still ass. But if you're playing a pub game and you're playing against a Chaos Knight and you're, you know, below,
and he gets that
4K,
RNG,
yeah, and if he gets the RNG and all of a sudden he presses his R button, you're fucking done, man. That's it. You're dead. You're not going to live long enough to say, hey, we can try to fight against the CK. It's Phantasm's down. No, you're all going to be dead. It's not going to matter. I don't understand why they changed that by 10 seconds. 24 to 34 is a big change. That's just, I don't really like playing against the CK. It's kind of annoying. And Greg and I have this experience where we played against the CK.
Dude, I'm actually having flashbacks.
It was awful.
We lost the Staff Cup literally because of Chaos Knight. And I think, you know, in like pro play, this is not that big of a deal.
It's not.
Because there's always going to be like an AoE stun or AoE something to sort of deal with it. The one thing that I can see is the problem is like, you know, 24 seconds, you could like stun them like twice and they would be much less effective. But with the really long duration, you really need like AoE clear. But for me, the problem with Chaos Knight is like the early, like his lack of mana pool in the early game. You know,
he just sucks,
that's
man.
One thing.
I mean, yeah, that's one thing.
He just sucks. That's the way you need to put it.
I mean, he's not, okay, he's not that bad relative to some other heroes. The big thing about Chaos Knight is that if he ever falls behind at any point in the game, he's screwed. Like, he has no...
Can't farm.
There's no AoE comeback mechanic. There's no... He has no flash farming ability whatsoever. I mean, he's a wonderful hero if you can kind of keep him steadily online in his growth between about 0 and 20 minutes, right? If he gets to a point in the game where he's got that, I don't know, treads, drums, armlet up at a reasonable time, he's really good. And he can actually, at, you know, 25 minutes or so, he can go toe-to-toe with a lot of other carries with a lot less farm.
Solo. Yeah, he can solo.
The problem is, as you look at how heroes have been drafted and thought about and valued in the pro metagame, risk is becoming so much more important. You can't have a hero like this is why Timbersaw, and we can talk about him later if you want to, because I think he got a big change, right? But this is why Timbersaw just disappeared from the game, because he's a hero that if he doesn't get his Bloodstone up by 20, 25 minutes at the very latest, he's worthless. He has zero game impact. He might as well not even be there. And that's kind of the problem with Chaos Knight in the pro meta is he's really, really good when he doesn't get shut down in the laning phase. But if he gets shut down in the laning phase, there's just no path back to him in the game.
True. I agree. That's true. Yeah.
What's your consider, the last thing I want to say about CK is you're talking about how he can man up in these fights and go toe-to-toe with people, but CK has also been notoriously known to also do some good split pushing. You'll be having an engagement. Next thing you look over and there's like 12
My base is
Chaos
gone.
Knights pushing into the base. And now with that much extra time, you're wiping out a tier 3, or you're wiping out a tier 2 rather, and then you still have plenty of time to move on into the base and go for a tier 3 as well.
Like,
so,
we killed three heroes and we got a tier 2 tower out of it, but our tier 3 and our rats is gone. So,
yeah.
What happens?
Army of CK coming into our base. What was the other hero you were gonna
the other one was actually Undying, and this is a hero that is he's got a very fond spot in my heart, because I think this hero is actually really good, especially in the pub scene and in the pro meta as well to a certain extent. I think he's underutilized, and some people picked him for a bit of time, like a month back, maybe even like this month as well. But Tombstone area of effect increased by a big chunk, pretty large chunk, it's a pretty nice change. Something about his Aghanim's Scepter Flesh Golem thing, which I don't really, whatever.
It's 5 and then, better.
Yeah, and then his Flesh Golem Slow Aura is increased from 9% to a variable from 5 to 15 based on distance to Undying, which some people were saying, I didn't even know Flesh Golem had a slow, but he does. I think this is a pretty good change. I think this is a hero that a lot of people are maybe underutilizing. And I think, again, and I've talked about this before, like, if you put him in the offlane in a pub game, and it's like a dual lane versus him.
Dude, he owns in pubs.
Undying is hilariously good
in pubs.
Two double decays, and you throw down your tombstone, and you just run over people. Like, you run over them. They die. Like, it's just that quick. And, like, they're like, can I get the number of that truck that just hit me as the Undying? So
if they run a tri-lane against you in a pub and you run into like players in a tri-lane that don't know how Undying works, oh God. Oh my God.
They're not hitting the tombstone, they're ignoring it completely. It gets scary.
It's the worst part.
It's over. If you get a couple double and triple decays, you have like 1 HP and you're like, it's like 2 minutes and you're just running at the tower and it doesn't matter. That hero was fun as hell to play. In the pro scene though, I think he's still pretty garbage, to be honest.
If you have to consider, Greg, other top priority offlaners have been nerfed down. Your Voids, even your Tidehunters got a lot, a touchdown a bit.
He's like
teams have already been experimenting with Undying. That could just put him just a hair higher onto the priority list. I think we'll see more of him.
The problem with him is he's just completely useless after the laning phase.
Yeah.
And in the pro scene, because in pubs, you put down a tombstone, everyone's too retarded to hit it. And it kills all the supports. In the pro scene, that does not happen. This hero is going to be awesome. He's going to be so good in pubs.
I'm playing this hero every game.
In pro scene, but
it's a slightly less severe version of the Ogre Magi problem, where, I mean, the hero can just kick so much ass in the first 20 minutes of the game, but how do you... Maut and I were talking about this last night during a game where EG kind of came out of left field with an Ogre Magi pick, and it was EG, wasn't it? I think
it was, right.
But it was like, how do you make this hero relevant past 20 minutes? And I haven't seen a winning formula for
enemy
that.
Team gets really a BKB and Ogre is a club hitting son of a gun. Right.
The answer is you cry yourself into a corner and you're like, why did I pick this hero? Which the games you did during that second game, like, we really want to end this game early. We want to be able to get out of here 2-0 so Zai can, you know, maybe get some sleep and actually go to school the next morning. And then they decided that they're going to pick an Ogre Magi and an Alchemist offlane for Universe, who I called one of the best players in the game, or the best players in Dota 2 in the third game, and he got shit on in that second game. I don't know what that draft was from Peter, but I'm just going to question it right now. So.
Yeah. Well, there's a couple other heroes that I want to mention. All right, here. Chen is definitely one of them.
Yeah.
Penitence got a little bit of a change, and I mean, there's a couple skill scaling things which don't really matter. The big change is that Penitence now amplifies the damage source instead of reapplying it as a percentage of damage that's physical. So the problem is that Penitence used to be like one of the worst skills in the game, because if you use it on a carry who has any armor, it just does nothing because it's reapplied as physical damage. Now the slow is a bit better, the range is a bit better, and as a result, I think he's actually a little bit more viable to be played like Enchantress. You can use him to gank a little bit better now that Penitence actually does something. And then also has an Ags upgrade that lets him target Ancient Creeps and can also target Spell Immune neutrals now, so he can get Mud Golems and stuff. So the Ags ultimate thing is pretty cool. Not sure how much it's going to matter, but...
Now let me put this bug in your head, though.
Occasionally he plays Ags, gets Ags.
Chen gets early farm, put him in a different role like your number two, and he gets an insta axe, gets a hold of the Ancient Creeps and goes for a crazy push strat right there. Viable, not viable?
He's got to remember that the number of Ancient Creeps is limited by levels in Hand of God.
Yeah, but if you put him in a primary position where he gets a wealth of XP and gold for himself, he can get level 11 at a reasonable time, and you got
two black dragons showing quick. Yeah, you got two black dragons showing up at your base at 15 minutes. That's no joke, right? I have a hard time seeing it being viable as anything other than a pocket strat, but you can't discard it out of hand. That's for sure.
Yeah. I think it's not like, you know, we're not going to see that all the time or anything, but...
Well, it could be a back pocket strat some teams can go for to really think outside the box and really put some other teams out of their comfort zone. They see a Chen, they figure it's a support. Next thing you know, you got, like you said, black dragons coming your way, and you're like, I don't even know how to deal with this right now. I'm not even comfortable going at ancients as it is. So
yeah. Here's the thing for me. The thing for me also is just like, everyone has been saying it, like, especially on Twitter and on Reddit, it's just like, oh my God, Chen mid, new meta. Like, just like they're saying all this shit, and then it's just like, do you remember what happened last patch where we had a ton of Aghanim changes for all these supports? Like, whoever builds an Aghanim scepter on Enigma right now? Does anybody do that ever? Does anybody build that item on a hero?
But Chen, there is a precedent of, like, occasionally...
You could go Ags, occasionally.
If the game goes past 40 minutes, you probably have an Ags.
Yes, but I want everyone to calm down and stop saying this, like, we're going to send this hero into this lane and get him farm in X, Y, or Z scenario, and it's just like, it's not going to happen.
But I think the thing is that there's such a limited pool of items for Chen. It's, like, Arcanes, Mech, maybe, like, a Force Staff, maybe a
Vlad's.
And Vlad's is, like, okay as a luxury item, and then the next best item is honestly Ags, because the 30-second... Hand of God is really good.
The important detail about this, this is not a hero that has to have mid. Okay, this is a hero that can farm fast in the jungle. He's not as fast as Enigma, but you don't necessarily, like, 15-minute Ags Chen coming out of the jungle is not crazy. Okay, if he does his job, if he takes some early towers, if he gets a couple of kills, this is not a hero that necessarily, you know, Warlock absolutely has to have mid to get that Ags at a good time for his golems. Chen does not absolutely have to have mid to get that Ags at a good time. That's the only thing that I'll throw out there saying, you know, this might be something more than just a totally crazy thing.
No, I
don't think it's going to have much impact.
I agree with you. Chen is a good farming hero. He can use other lanes. It's just that it's the thought process of sending X, Y, or Z hero into
a
lane.
You can't mid every hero, right? It's like,
what?
It doesn't. Yeah, right. Yeah, like what you're saying is you can't just throw a hero in mid and not expect him to get killed. Like,
right. That's what I'm telling everyone to calm down, relax, don't build Aghanim Scepter on every hero because, you know, 60% of the time that item's ass on that hero. So, like,
it's okay on that hero, I think.
No, it is. I'm not saying it's okay on Chen. It is. It's fine. But, like, there's other Aghanim Scepter upgrades that are just like, why would you ever build that? I don't understand. So,
okay. All right, fair enough.
This helps with bad RNG in the jungle. Sometimes you just get too many mud golems, and now you can actually make use of it. So that's nice. Yeah. I'm sure here, you know, players like Aoi, like your Ake, are going to be a little happier with this, and we might see Chen make a sort of a reappearance in this.
It's just a small buff. You know, the penitence buff is, I think, a bigger deal than the Axe buff, to be honest.
It may be. It may end up being. That's a good
penitence
point.
Penitence was literally garbage before, like unusable, honestly, because you couldn't gain carries with it because they had armor. There's a couple more quick things that I do want to go through for heroes. There's a lot of big changes that I think are important.
I know. It's hard. It's a patch is so wanna, big, there, it's hard quick, to just not talk about the patch.
There's a quick things that we can talk about. Magnus Empower is no longer removed by Spell Muni.
Crazy.
Nakes with Empower sounds absurd. Mm-hmm. That's like my quick impressions on
that. Put that together with Sven and how somehow maybe like even in the late game he gets an Agnums and you got 2-3 cores on your team and now you got that plus in power. It gets out of hand real quick. I mean,
Phantom Lancer, there's another. I mean,
Phantom Lancer's
change.
New. Bloodseeker's a whole new hero altogether now, even though he's not in Captain's mode. It's just, you're looking at this stuff. We've seen the videos. You guys
Why
know what
you
we're talking
take
about.
Bloodseeker out of the damn game. Like,
Bloodseeker really? Seems pretty awful still.
Really?
No.
He seems beyond garbage tier now. But, yeah. I mean, there are all these people out here talking about, oh, no, you know, if you have AoE stun, this new Blood Rite's going to be great. I think Bloodseeker is sub-trash tier.
We'll have to see. The proof is in the pudding when it actually gets in the players' hands and they have the opportunity to use it and go, and then they pull out these crazy loot, new synergies and things you never even thought of. I mean, no one even touched Skywrath until TI4 qualifiers are rolling around. They're like, oh my god, this is the best support we've ever seen in our life, you know?
That silence was so good against, like, Slark. It was one of the only reasons why that hero was ever picked in the game. Just because, like, oh, there's a Slark. Let's just pick a Bloodseeker and we'll win the game now. So,
yeah,
why do they change that?
A couple more things. Speaking of that note, Skywrath, small nerfs, whatever. He's a little worse now. I don't think that hero's that OP, so whatever.
It's not. Really isn't. If you look, I mean, the pick rate
he just offers so much.
Void nerfed into the ground. Elder Titan, I think, is a huge one. Elder Titan's back, and like he's already been seeing play recently. These buffs are ridiculous, honestly. Like, absurd. I see no reason. I don't understand why these buffs are a thing.
40% at level one natural order.
That is ridiculous.
What?
The Ag Scepter does not matter, but the rest these other changes are stupid. That hero is going to be ridiculously good now.
That is the band fighting hero.
LC's in Captain's mode. Only time will tell if these nerfs are good enough to make her not broken as hell.
Oh, God. If mid LC had been a thing in the pro meta, oh, Lord. Oh.
What else we got in here? That's Puck has an Ags upgrade now. That's actually pretty good.
Yeah. Put it together with a four staff
or something.
It seems
reasonable. It seems like a reasonable item choice in some games against the right heroes. And then Quap also got buffed, which I kind of like because now Puck and Quap both got.
You're really
buffed.
Making Sam work by now. He's like jumping up and down the heroes on the change log. Like, really, what is he talking about? I gotta go up and down right here to try to find them all.
But Puck and Quap both got buffed. Some reason Quap's basic attack time got buffed, which is just hilarious because it's already like one of the best in the game.
1.7 is not that great, but
I mean her animation
is really good. Yeah, her animation is good.
Is there anything else here that matters?
Nahaz,
sure, we're missing
a lot.
Do you
have a particular favorite hero?
I mean, there's other stuff in here that's relevant. Like Earthshaker got a little bit. We can go into this later, but Earthshaker got a very indirect nerf by changing spell damage on Echo Slam, and that's now its magic damage, which is a pretty big deal.
Yeah,
DP is still amazing, but everything else got nerfed so hard that it doesn't matter. Klinks is going to be scary now.
Klinks, yeah, I really do wonder whether Klinks could be a Roshan hero now.
Klinks Deso is
could be like that 7 minute
horrifying.
I'm gonna have to try it out, but I think Klinks might be like a 7 minute Rosher now.
It's possible. I mean, you get a lifesteal item and
yeah, exactly.
Pretty good. Broodmother got some sweet changes, which are gonna make her way more viable. She can change lanes now without it being horrible. She's still not in Captain's mode, though. Bounty Hunter got a ridiculous change, which is the stupidest thing on the planet. The Shuriken Toss thing is completely absurd.
That's awesome.
I don't know if it's OP or not, but
it adds just like a nice new little thing. It's not OP or anything. It's just like, oh, that's nice. If you manage to get like two or three tracks off in a fight and you throw maybe two Shurikens, you're getting more splash out of it. So it's just a nice little add-on.
Razor's still going to be OP as hell, I think. Razor's still going to be really good. But again, the style that Razor goes with is shit now. So,
yeah, that's the thing. It's so hard for me to talk about a lot of these individual hero changes without knowing how the meta is going to settle. But I mean, have we mentioned Tinker?
Tinker
is
in
the game
now.
I thought he was
Tinker
just killed. I thought they just destroyed him.
I mean,
he's pretty much unplayable now.
It's stupid. Like
this nerf is just too much. I think.
I hate Tinker. I'm tired of him, like everybody else is. But yeah, I really do honestly think that this nerf just kills him completely. Bye bye.
Yeah. No, he's gone. He is not. Weaver got a really nice set of buffs. Weaver with Manta and Diffusal is going to be fucking awesome now.
Yeah.
I'm definitely going to do that.
It's also nice that those buffs apply. They apply to builds that he was already using. Like Deso is even better on him, which was already really good.
Like so. Diffusal is going to be actually awesome on him now. Yep. And then I think that covers most of the big changes for heroes.
Trigon Magnum's ult. I mean, it's not it's too expected that he's going to.
It's interesting.
It's interesting. That's what it is. Like, there's niche there, but him farming the ags, that's a whole other story. But in pub play and stuff, it could be something pretty surprising. I always loved his Eyes of the Forest ability. I loved it way back in the day, the free set of wards, and now he kind of get it back. Plus the nice little combo effect that you can use his ult anytime, anywhere globally, as long as someone's near it. So he could be a global presence, not just with his living armor, but now with his ultimate if he does get a hold of the Agnum Scepter. So it's neat. It's fun, and it adds a whole new flavor to the game. Is it going to be in pro play and it's going to be the best thing ever? No, probably not. But it does add a nice flavor to the game, and I love that ability. I like the hero a bit, and might be something I might consider playing.
Should
all that global vision would be very nice to have.
Should we try and talk about Ricky? Because this is just freaking strange.
Yeah, pretty different now.
Do you think he's good now? I don't know.
I think he might change roles. I think he actually might be a decent support now.
I think like the charges on the ult thing is kind of interesting to me because it definitely fixes one of the worst things about him.
Yeah, exactly.
But I don't know. I mean, I think he's still going to be a fine pub carry.
I look at these changes and I really am eight kind seconds. Of two minds about
fear,
it.
I fear for the trench. All right.
Oh, the trench.
This is already a top pickup. This was a top pickup in the trench, and now you're telling me he gets
permanent
invisibility off the
bat
in games where no one gets dust or sentries.
Yeah,
that's going to be the top pick ever in pub trench play. It's going to get out of hand real quick.
Rename the hero EGM. I mean, give me a break. Spirit Breaker got a nice set of buffs. I think he probably still is bad, but the charge thing makes a lot of sense. Like to not have to worry about activating your charge and having the thing that you're charging die right away and just, oh, well, that was 30 seconds completely wasted is kind of nice. And there are a couple of, by the way, Charlie has been the voice of reason in chat. I think the
he's
world
just some
is
some guy
ending.
Like shouting in the crowd, like, shut the hell up. You're wrong.
That's Charlie's, exactly it.
He said a couple of things that were like, yeah, I'm a dumbass. I mean, he's like, you know, he was very nice about it. He was like, you know, the whole Bloodstone thing, that's probably not why Timber disappeared. And a couple other people were like, yeah, Nahaz, it's probably because of the chain stun thing on Timber chain. And I was like,
he's just like the nicest asshole on the face of the planet. You're like,
you lost because you suck.
And you go up to the guy.
Thanks,
and you talk to him and you're just like, this guy is so lovable. Then he just calls you an idiot. You're like, oh, yeah. You know, it's just kind
of
like,
you son of a bitch.
It's just funny. He's a good guy.
Gentlemen, are we over the hero talk now?
We're done with heroes.
I think we're good.
Before we finally step away from the patch, there's a couple other small things. We got a new item. How long had it been since we've seen a new item introduced to the game? The Crimson Guard.
This item seems buckler sweet.
Has another use.
This is when you're building buckler and your other teammate's building a mech, and he's just like, all right, well, I got to build something now. I got a buckler here. I can't just sell it. Time to build a Crimson Guard. I don't even know what it fucking does, but let's do it. So. That's what it is, in my opinion.
I think it's good in a couple situations when you're like manning up really early.
It's like a pipe for physical damage. It's nice.
That's fair.
Yeah.
I mean, I don't think it's the best thing ever or anything, but I think it's pretty good.
The wording of the tooltip is a little bit strange because it says it has a damage block shell that has a 100% chance to block 50 damage.
Yeah, that's an active.
Well, I know it is an active, but the question is, because of the wording, I'm not clear whether that blocks it, whether it works like pipe, because spell block is actually cumulative. It'll block as many instances of magic damage as it can until it gets up to 400, or whether it's a single instance of damage up to 50. So if like a tree hits you, then you're blown.
I think my impression of maybe is that's probably completely wrong. I don't know what my impression.
I don't know. I think it probably works like pipe, except it works on all sources of damage, but I'm not sure. or maybe just physical damage.
Yeah, you definitely don't buy it for the active, though. I think it's more the regen, HP, and extra damage block it plus armor.
I mean, it's okay. I just still go back to a question I've asked in a couple casts recently. Like, why isn't Vanguard disassemblable? Like, I've heard in the past a bunch of people say, okay, well, if Vanguard could be disassembled, it would be OP. And I'm like, okay.
The item's shit now. So.
Right. How do you get from one of the worst built items in the game to OP, especially because it seems to me like most of the heroes that would get a nice indirect buff, Spectre being one big one, possibly also Centaur, are heroes that, you know, you can kind of argue be decent.
Yeah. I don't know. Anyway. Well, let's see. Is there any... Most of these other item changes are pretty normal. There's a lot of changes on here that are evening up the components.
Yeah,
with the final build item, which is just like should happen.
The stuff changes.
Butterfly has a cool new active. Yeah. Butterfly's active seems cool.
Move Flutter. Speed if you need to, you know, get somewhere quickly, I guess.
Yeah.
You know,
I mean, it seems neat. It doesn't seem great or anything, but the Bloodstone remake, I think, is pretty big.
I think that's really nice. I think that's actually huge. A really nice
because
buff,
a lot,
along with the Axe buff.
Yeah, I think it's a nice. Exactly. I think it's a nice buff. I think it's fairly good for Storm Spirit as well.
Yeah, it's a really good Storm buff.
Possibly even like Clinks. There are a bunch of heroes. Like,
there's
a lot of heroes.
Yeah.
Go watch EE stream, right? I mean, there are actually
anyone that EE plays.
Just any hero.
There's a lot of heroes. Every hero.
Yeah.
Yep.
Another item change is pretty big. Is BKB is now tied to your hero.
That's
and the minimum is 5. I think this is fine. Although this was on Reddit, but I hope BKB becomes sellable now. There's no reason for it not to be.
I agree.
I mean, you're still going to need a plastic iteration, though.
I think that's just a consistency thing where, like, they haven't remembered to put it in yet. They probably didn't even agree.
I don't know if you're really ever going to sell a BKB,
corner cases where you would sell it, like mega late game. Like, maybe. Plus 60 minutes, BKB is sometimes mediocre.
So. Now, how much do you... I mean... Do you build a Lincoln Spear if it's in the late game now in certain situations? What do you do in that situation?
It depends on the hero you're playing. You can.
I guess so.
Like, you know, on like an AM, BKB becomes just worse than like Heart Butterfly, you know, stuff like that. So,
it is nice, by the way, that Maelstrom and Mjolnir no longer trigger Lincolns. That was kind of bullshit.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I'd agree with that.
That was annoying.
I mean, those are just small little
tweaks.
Nerfs for Maelstrom and Mjolnir, which are needed. That item's too good. And then there's
you needed to buff Mask of Madness. That's pretty weird to me.
I think it's fine. Like, it's not like
fun the way it was. It didn't need 100 gold.
It's not going to argue over 100 gold. Like, I do think, by the way, the 100 gold, this very slight nerf to Blink Dagger is a good thing.
So leading into the next big difference, which we can go over quickly, the damage type changes.
Yes.
Okay.
I'm not sure if this is going to stay. But Urn now is just the best item in the world against Blink Dagger carriers because it's magical damage now.
That's true.
And it burns off Blink Daggers, which is a huge deal. That's like, how long is a negative Urn charge? It's like 10 seconds or something.
It's a lot.
And does this mean like Heartstopper aura now disables?
No, because Heartstopper is now negative HP regeneration, but Urn is pure. So they did some weird... There's some weird stuff that I think will probably still be changed. I don't think Urn should be able to turn off Blink Dagger.
Okay.
That seems like it'll be way too good. Although maybe they just want to nerf Blink Dagger. I don't know.
Some of these changes seem kind of weird. I mean, the whole damage type thing in itself just makes for some unusual cases, especially in the test client. Obviously, a lot of these things are going to get fixed, but they're still, like...
Someone in chat is saying it does disable Blink in the test client. So if that's true, then I have no problem with the Urn change.
Agreed.
And then there's a bunch of damage type changes here that... I think we sort of talked about this a little bit before the show, but now there's only 3 types. It basically just lowers the barrier of entry to the game a little bit. And they also made a bunch of changes that sort of line those up with the new changes. A couple heroes do disadvantage a little bit from this. Beastmaster a little bit. Earthshaker a little bit more than most of the heroes. Because now when you Echo Slam, it's not nearly as good. The rest of them, I don't think, are that big of a deal. They pretty much work like you would think they
would.
Wait,
somebody has What Is Shit TV as their handle on Gurg Squad. Who is that?
Bleak.
Is it Bleak?
Yeah, it's Bleak.
Oh, well, I hate to tell you this, but they're losing now.
Yeah, I know, I heard. I don't want to talk about that.
Sorry.
I don't want to be sad, man.
Somebody in chat is suggesting at least that Batrider gets the Sticky Napalm damage bonus now with his Urn.
Yeah, that's a bug.
Yeah.
Okay, good.
I think that's been confirmed as a bug.
Yeah. And then that, obviously the big thing we haven't talked about this is SF has a new remodel.
Oh yeah, he looks awesome. Good. Which is cool.
It's the most badass hero looking game in the game the right Arcana, now. He looks so the Arcana. Badass.
I don't know. I'm sure.
He looks like Ragnaros from.
Yes, I was gonna say that. He looks exactly like Rag. And like that gets my inner WoW nerd going a little bit. So I'm just like, yeah, cool. I mean, it's like, I don't know. It's so nice for me, but I don't know.
There's this new change with which I suspect will be changed. That's special raise status effect that displays Overshadow Fiend when the same enemy is raised multiple times. I think in a little bit this is kind of bordering on that same thing that happened with Techies, where what happens if you raise someone who's like in fog or something, you know? Then you get a status thing, you know, you hit them. It's not pay to win, but it's an adjustment that I think will be made. So if he's like in fog, it won't show it or whatever. Yeah, it's like Nahaz died, but he'll come
back. Rip Nahaz. Nice kid, though. I think I can squeeze my face into his frame right here if I stand like this. Hi, I'm part of the family right now in the hospital.
Hey.
I stand right here.
He's back.
Hey,
I'm back.
Oh, there's the video. So, okay.
Welcome so, back. I don't know. I mean, beyond that, I don't think most of these changes are relevant, obviously, but I don't know if we really need to talk about any of these. Does anyone else, I guess, have anything else they want to add on here? There's a million changes we could talk about.
Like,
yeah, that's kind of thing.
The patch, man. I just want
to. You got to cut it off at some point. Unfortunately,
I'm ready. I'm ready to play the patch, and
yeah,
we'll see what happens.
Let's get on a test client, boys.
I'm ready to go. But that's it. That's going to finally conclude. We took a nice girthy hour talking about the patch.
Girthy.
But believe it or not, we're a show that we need to talk about other Dota news as well. And there's been other stuff. Everyone's so crazy and hyped about the patch, but there's been some other things that's been happening this week or has been announced. So let's finally step away from the patch and move on to the next thing up on our docket. And that's going to be some sort of tournament info and update talk. And the first one is a very special one to us, without being too biased, I hope. Dota Pit League season number 2, baby. We're back. $75,000 up for grabs here, a European and American division league, and it's going to be happening at the end of September through November 30th. 16 NA and European teams. What a roster going to be thrown together for this one. Look at this. What we got here? We got EG, VP Polar, VP, Empire, Power Rangers, Secret Team, Team Tinker, Complexity, Sneaky, Nyx Assassins, Cloud9 Alliance, Fnatic, Moscow 5, Meet Your Makers, Navi US, and Denial. What a lineup here of action that could be coming your way. And, of course, none other than HighGroundTV is going to be bringing you the exclusive action. So we're really excited about this one. This has been Greg's pride and joy right now. Greg, without further ado, please, if you'd love to give a little more information about the tournament, the floor is yours.
Yeah, so this has been, if anyone has talked to me in the last 3 weeks, I've been extremely stressed out, not really been sleeping, et cetera, pretty much because of this tournament. And a lot of planning have gone into this, and I have now discovered exactly how hard it is to really plan one of these things. Originally, we were just going to be the broadcasters for this tournament, but I've taken on a much bigger role in sort of planning everything, dealing with everything. And, you know, if I say so myself, we have assembled. Yeah, exactly. We have assembled like the 16 best teams in outside of China, I guess, besides Navi EU.
We didn't want to play on the servers, by the way.
Did not want to play any games on US East, completely refused.
But look, so, I respect gone. That.
But,
honestly.
I mean, I respect that decision. But we were not about changing the rules.
If you hear about some of the stuff that like VP apparently pulled in this series with Complexity, where basically VP said, you know, we're not playing any games on US East, we'll just forfeit. And Complexity's like, well, I mean, I guess we could take a deaf win, but we'd rather have the games played and have our fans get to see us. I actually respect what Navi EU did a hell of a lot more. If you don't want to play on a server, don't sign up for a damn online tournament.
Yeah, so obviously this is the sort of crux of the mixed region online tournament, is that you have these issues with servers, especially I think it becomes more of an issue when you get into best of threes and best of fives. Because the way that we're running this tournament is two groups of eight with two game series. So the
which
first
is the way to do it, by which, the way.
So it's a point system based on the wins you get, one win per map win. And then the thing that I really like about this format is, now when you have teams, because really the issues are the Russian-Ukrainian teams and the NA teams, because the Western Europe teams can pretty much play on East. It doesn't really matter. But you know, when you get to like Ukraine and Russia and like West Coast, like EG, yeah. US East is like sort of the middle ground there. Occasionally, it's a little bit more favorable for one team than the other, depending on exactly where they live. So what we've decided to do for these two game series is split them. So one is on East, one is on EU West, Luxembourg, to sort of, you know, make it as fair as possible through the group stages, which is obviously the majority of the games. So I hope people are happy with the structure that we've gone with. It's a definitely much a little bit unconventional sort of way we're actually laying out the tournament. The single elimination bracket at the end is for the, you know, semifinals, quarterfinals, semifinals, and finals. So single elim, the bracket at the end is very cutthroat. Every game's going to matter quite a bit. And it's obviously it's a huge prize pool, $75,000.
Yeah.
And this has sort of been my baby for the last couple of weeks. So
we
have schemes to make the online broadcast as good as possible. So I hope you guys are excited for it.
Let me comment on a couple of things you said, because I want to actually pay you a compliment here. Like I think two things, right? First of all, what can you ask in terms of tournament organization and structure, right? Okay. The first thing I think you can ask is that people put some thought behind it and are trying to make the games as fair as possible, are trying to provide the best competitive environment for both the teams and the fans. And I think check. And then the second thing, which to me is really irritating and I get way too little of in a lot of the tournaments that I cover even, is clarity. Is that it's all spelled out there, that the rules are on the table for all to see. You don't have to have, I mean, these admins for Join Dota, right? Most of whom are volunteers and are just great kids, right? Most of them are in school, okay? They have other shit to be doing. And they're sitting here getting yelled at by like players who understandably are pissed off and frustrated because they weren't told the rules. They don't understand the way they are, why they are the way they are. And this is just a situation that is good for nobody. And yeah. So I appreciate that you guys have obviously put a lot of thought into it. And the other thing is it's about time, because I mean, I will not speak for BTS. I don't know. Like, the first time I've worked with BTS was with Maut last night, which was great. I thank you again. But I've worked a ton with JD, and I mean, their schedule is just getting stupid. Like, Toby and Cap are up like all hours of the damn night. And Cap is like, you know, his stream title is 25/8 casting because 24/7 is for wussies. There needs to be some other presence in the casting scene besides JD and BTS that can deal with a big tournament, because there are going to be more and more big tournaments. And so, you know, kudos to you guys for stepping up to the plate.
Yeah.
And, you know, I can say I'm not officially affiliated with High Ground, so I can at least appear to be somewhat unbiased, although yeah. I bullshit.
Whatever. Appreciate that. We're excited. This is like a big opportunity for us as casters to be able to take on something like this. And like you said, a lot of the other bigger studios have a lot on their plate, so we're happy to get a big table scrap right there in our favor that we can really hope to prove ourselves as casters, because we have a lot of passion for what we do, and we're really excited to have the opportunity to take control of this and have a lot of big games coming our way. And, you know, I know I speak for Ma, and Greg has been doing a lot of work behind the scenes getting this together, and he definitely deserves all the props, considering how salty and rude he is.
Anyone who has like watched any of our shows recently or anything, organizing this has been the primary outlet of my aggravation. Suns fan, if you guys watched last week, Suns fan was talking about how I just was raging at him for like 3 days straight, and it was because I needed to rage at someone. So LD got a huge piece of that. Suns fan got a huge piece of that. But we have some cool online stuff planned. So hopefully you guys are really happy with the broadcast. I think it should be really good. Maut will be casting a vast majority of this. With various
where can they find the stream, Greg? Where is the action going to be at?
Well, the stream at the moment is like Dota Pit Tournament _EN or something. But it's going to be changed to just twitch.tv/DotaPit. Like I said, we started originally as just the broadcasters for this tournament, and very quickly I picked up a lot more stuff. So a lot of our personal planning has sort of gone into this tournament. So it's our baby at the moment. So
yeah. We're looking forward to it.
We keep talking about it, but we're going to keep talking about it. But yeah, honestly, there's going to be some amazing games in this tournament with the way the groups are laid out. And just all the humongous, like the caliber of teams in this tournament is as good as it gets. Like, it's amazing. So I'm really excited.
Yeah, wow. We all are. So please.
The world is ending. You just got a little bit of love in chat from Charlie.
Like, whoa. Someone has gotten a hold of Charlie's account, apparently. Charlie, you might want to change your email, reset your password a bit, because that's not you. That's
Charlie is one of the organizers of the most stubborn team in the world. So, you know, sometimes you just
got them for this one.
We got them for
the ADL, but we got them for this one, boys.
They might have dodged and abandoned the ADL, but, you know.
They owed us. They owed us this one. We got him.
Oh boy, yeah. We're but I have a real job too, so I've been working two jobs for the last 2 weeks, and it's been very fucking stressful. But all good things have happened, and people seem really excited about the tournament. So we're just as excited. So
yep. Look forward to that action to come. I believe it starts as early as next week. You might see some Dota Pit action coming.
I think
your way.
In theory, it's going to start on Monday. Not 100% sure. We want the ticket to be in the game. Oh, the ticket is going to be $9.99. It's going to come with a Lich set, which was
awesome.
On the stream earlier today. It was supposed to come with a different set, but Volvo, please. Took our
I think
ass.
A lot of people really have liked the Lich set, so I think that's not going to be a problem. They're going to really enjoy that one. So look out for the action there. You can follow HighGround TV on Twitter to see when the games are going to be happening. I believe there's also a Dota Pit Twitter to look out for, so make sure you go and check that out. But let's go ahead. We'll move on. Try not to be too unbiased here. We're actually getting crunched for time, so I'm going to try to roll through some of the other tournament updates and action that's been happening. The NVIDIA Game 24 event has concluded, that 24-hour gaming event and Dota tournament, which actually ended up being very entertaining. There was some nail-biting games right there, which happened between Alliance and Team Tinker. Their game number 3 went down to a very, very close base race, which made it considered one of the best Dota matches we've seen of the year. So definitely check out that one if you can. But overall, an impressive run by Cloud9, who ended up taking it in the end. They first beat out EG 3-1 and then took Team Tinker in the grand finals 3-1 as well and walked away with $7,000. So an impressive performance by them. So before we step away from this one, guys, I know you've seen a bit of Cloud9 recently. Do you think they're really starting to come together? Are they looking good, better than ever? What do you think? Huh?
Cloud9 is the real fucking deal, man. Right? They're playing
really,
real well.
They're really fucking good, man.
Fada, I think losing Sing Sing and getting Fada was one of the best things that ever happened to that team. Nothing personal for Sing Sing, but just his play style, I think,
right,
does not really fit. And I know that Fada communicates a lot better. He also rages a lot more, but
Fada's just one of the best players in the world.
Fada is one of the most underrated players in the world, for sure. I will never understand. I mean, his play style has been what it is forever. He is almost always the highest average assists per game of any mid player. He's incredibly consistent. And if you look at Cloud9, it was not hard to figure out Cloud9. Cloud9's big problem was always kind of that laning phase, the transition into the mid game. Their execution in those team fights was not necessarily what you wanted it to be. They were a very efficient farming team, but they had trouble making that transition sometimes. And that is the point at the game where Fada is steadiest, where he's going to get that mech almost every time, where he's going to play a rather large pool of heroes, and he's going to be a steadying presence in team fights. Whereas Sing Sing, I did the numbers on this a while back, and if you did the split, they had a 90% win rate when Sing Sing had twice as many kills as deaths, and they had a 35% win rate when he didn't. And that was by far the biggest split of any major mid player. Like, it was they were all in on Sing having a good game, and that's not Sing's fault. I mean, he's a great player. He's an amazing
player.
It's
just the style of play he
plays. Exactly.
Right? It was like Potom, Ember, you know, heroes like that.
And it's the thing, if you got to look at it like an NFL or an NBA roster. Fada addressed a need for them, and he's a great pickup.
Mm-hmm. Yep, so fantastic performance from them in their run. Congratulations, $7,000 in their pocket, ready to go. Next tournament up on the docket, we got the Sina Cup Season 5, a tournament that I know modded personally and I had personally gotten the cast. But in the end, it was IG that came out on top. They actually upset VG Gaming, the team that many considered to be the new dream team, the new DK, if you will. They actually took them down 3-2 in that final best of five and walking away with roughly about $8,500 US dollars. So not too bad. And impressive performance before we truck on. Maut, did you were you expecting that kind of an outcome from IG?
I mean, it was either IG or VG Gaming. Those two teams being that good did not surprise me. And honestly, I think YGaming put up a decent fight in the games they played. I was really impressed with their play style, which was, you know, kind of sit back and make sure the lanes are pushed out and take fights when, you know, you need to take fights. It was just really solid, you know, Dota. But again, I talked about this last week, and I keep talking about it. The Chinese scene doesn't look all that great right now. I mean, even IG are still making mistakes. VG Gaming is looking pretty good, but they still make mistakes here and there. I just think that the scene is, it's not really that great right now. And again, we've seen this happen, you know, before, where the Chinese scene just kind of falls off for, you know, a couple of months. I think there's still some really strong teams there, but I still think that right now, if, you know, VG or IG were to go up against EG, which we're going to see pretty soon.
You're going to get fucking stomped.
I think we could see a close match, but I don't know. I still think EG will probably win.
Things get flipped upside down. You never really know, right?
Fuck.
Tables have turned.
You remember when DK, you know, the new patch came out and DK struggled with it for a bit of time. And, you know, just some of these Chinese teams have a really tough time of figuring out the new patches. And I think that EG really thrives on understanding it, and it, because they everyone just kind of tinkers with it, you know, and I think that EG and C9 tinkers do that the best. All right, Greg. This is so funny.
Really?
Oh, really?
That was the low hanging fruit, man, and I just had to grab it.
You're dumb.
Low hanging something.
You're just an idiot sometimes, man. I love you, but I hate you, so.
Oh, man.
Next up, as far as Eastern scene, we got the I-League, which actually I believe starts up in about 5-6 hours from now. You can see the first game going underway. The LAN finals will begin. BTS is bringing the action. I believe it will be LD and Sinran bringing you the action. As far as recent news, as far as the tournament, DK was the team to actually pull out. They, remember, had the automatic invite because, well, they were DK at the time, but things have changed. They have a new roster, and they decide to withdraw. So, you know, what do you think, guys? Is it just because they don't feel worthy of having the invite anymore because they're not the DK team they used to be? Do you think they, you know, succumb to the pressure of it? Do you think it's a valued decision by their part to kind of hand over? Because now it's going to be LGD, Newbie, and Hyper Glory team that are going to compete for the new spot.
Didn't one of these teams already get the slot? Oh, Newbie got the slot.
Yeah,
Newbie got the slot. So
I think there's something that happened that we don't know about, because that just seems very odd to me. I don't care who you are. I mean, do you want to compete for a couple $100,000?
Wait, what? Hold on. I realized that we just said this, but what was the team that got? Oh, DK. Okay.
DK. Yeah.
God, DK's out.
I'm sorry. No,
they have gotten the automatic invite when they were the DK, but things have changed, and you know, it looked like they were still going to honor the invite, but they have opted to pull out. So with reasons that have not been put out there in public.
It sounds like the roster is a sack of shit. That's what it sounds like.
Right? Well, there's the GERG facts about it, but you know, we'll see. That action is going to be coming in a couple hours, so we'll see which team.
He doesn't play punches, anybody. Ladies and gentlemen, GERG.
Ladies and gentlemen.
It sounds like they looked at the roster and they're like,
honest
holy
report,
shit, GERG. Look at our life choices, boys. We can't compete in public.
Like, well, we really haven't had a real game together.
Oh,
I don't know how we're going to stand, so. You know, we'll see how it ends up turning out. You know, props though as
Greg Laird, Newbie. Ladies and gentlemen.
Newbie is gonna take the slot in a team that's obviously gonna put up a bit of a fight, so that should be good stuff. Star Ladder, season 10, American Division, EG have secured their spot in the grand finals after taking out Navi US in the winner bracket file, which knocked Navi US down to the losers now, where they will now face the Sneaky Knicks Assassins. The winner will then move on to play EG, and then that winner goes to Kiev. So
what a great series that was. That Navi US versus EG series. Nahaz and I were getting fucking hyped about that one, man. And shout out to Korok, because he played unbelievably, and especially in that second game, man. God, I love when he plays like heroes like the Ursa. He just goes fucking nuts. And also, he had the Swift Claws, which are autographed by me, and I keep like blushing whenever I think.
Oh
like,
my God, shut up.
Get
come
on,
boys.
The nipple totem was used in full force.
That's right.
Seriously, that team Navi US has there are a lot of people that have not spoken very highly of that team. I mean, I think I think Emil Davi's in the chat, and I think she did a meet and greet with Aoi 2000 and Arteezy, if I remember correctly. And they got asked during that, you know, whether they thought that Navi US team had any potential, and they were both like, you know. And I mean, not necessarily dissing them, but you know, I don't know that. As I've asked a lot of people around the scene, a lot of people have been like, "Well, I don't know." Well,
I'm gonna pull the blanket up a little bit here. There was some serious internal issues on the side of Navi US,
but that's the funny thing. They've been really good lately, even with all the stand-ins, yeah, all the craziness.
But they have sort of settled their shit. They had some conflicting personalities on their team, and well, they've taken care of it. So hopefully they've turned over a new leaf. I don't know if Fog's in the chat, so he can say more things about it if he wants
We're not talking about Fog, Greg. Right. Not one bit.
People. Yeah, fuck you, Fog. Fucking Yannis.
Hey. Anyways.
Yo, he dodged, dude. He dodged.
If people didn't know, Fog was originally one of the people we were going to ask to be on the show, but as the show progresses, I'm very happy with Nahaz being here. And Fogged, if you want to come back and send an apologies, we will accept it.
The thing
and
that
you guys
dodged,
lost, dude. You guys
he
lost.
Dodged the first week, and he continues to dodge to this day. So
he's
I don't know.
Fucking dodging.
That's the big thing for me. Like, it's fine, you know, if you want to dodge 1 week, that's okay. But just fucking get your shit together, man. I'm sorry, that was a little cruel.
All right. Let's ease back a bit, folks. Chinese region up next for Star Ladder, VG Newbie, Hyper Glory Team, and Light Gaming were the four teams for the double elimination bracket of the Chinese division, with the top two teams going to the LAN. Chinese division playoffs were also the 22nd through 24th of September, but two teams made it to the LAN instead of just the one American team. Playoffs actually have already finished, and it was Newbie and VG that have qualified for the LAN finals in October. So some of the two best teams that we were hoping to see, you know, make it on through, even though it feels like
nothing
a limited
unexpected
talent pool right now. So they make it on through. We're all excited to see the likes of, you know, your Black Ice and company and the former TI4 champions being able to duke it out at Star Ladder Land. So that should be all exciting. Of course, BTS going to be bringing you that action. Next tournament up, excellent Moscow Cup, or EMC, if you will. Newbie have pulled out of the LAN finals of the EMC after one of their players have lost their passport.
So, you fucking morons. How does this keep happening? Jesus Christ, it's your passport. It's not like your favorite pen. What the fuck? Keep it in a safe place. So, how is this so complicated?
I think that's just an excuse because they don't want to go and play the EMC, which, by the way, can I just I don't think I've talked about this, but the name Excellent Moscow Cup is just
Excellent Moscow Cup.
It is really freaking weird, but it's been a good tournament.
Next year's going to be called the Gnarly Moscow. Radical also, Moscow.
And shout out to Pimp Muckle, who has done a great job with that tournament. And I've been on a couple times with him, and he's had Wakey Pixel co-casting, who's not as well known in the scene, but he's
legit, dude.
Yeah, he's done very well, I felt, with those games. So I think he's going to go places.
I'd agree. Yep. I think Wakey is...
So look forward to that action. Group stage is over. Navi, Empire, Invertus, Pro, Polar are the teams that are going to the LAN along with LGD Gaming this week, and that's the 26th through the 27th of September. We'll see how it goes. You know, save your predictions as we move on through the WCA 2014. Just a reminder, folks, WCA, if you didn't know what it was, that's the Chinese event that has a whopping $325,000 for the first place team. Holy
and
80, moly.
Yeah, 80% of the prize pool is going to first place.
Yeah, it's almost
bloated.
It's almost first place takes all. It's a huge deficit.
It might as well be
first, second
third
place.
Is like $4,000. It's like, thanks for coming. Hopefully this covers your drinking for the week.
That's nuts. Like the fourth place prize is like
your travel.
Nothing.
That's it.
No. Well,
hey guys, congrats on your win. Here's some Heinekens. You know, you can have these. Actually, we couldn't afford Heinekens. They're PBRs, but you know, it's ridiculous. But it's gonna make.
Do they even have PBR in China?
I hope not.
No, probably not.
We got an imported special. But Yeah, you know what, though? It's going to make for a super intense grand finals. When that much money is the difference between first and second place, you're going to see some teams really sweat it out. And it was also announced recently that Beyond the Summit, another fantastic tournament for the BTS guys, are going to be providing the coverage for it. So expect the great soothing voices of Gods, Merlini, Ziori, and, of course, LD's wow factor. That's right.
Wow!
Ow! Hold on.
Wow!
There it is right there. Fantastic. Next event up, ESL One New York. We talked about it every week as new stuff comes out for this.
They just keep plopping things down 1 week at a time, like, so it keeps getting on
wait,
the docket.
There's more. Yeah. You know, it just keeps coming. Mad Catz is announced as another sponsor for ESL One New York, and also a fancy new chest is going to be coming out. New ESL One New York chest been announced separate to the ticket will contribute to the prize pool. So a lot of people were a bit skeptical as far as ticket sales in comparison to a lot of the other tournaments. Well, this is going to help a lot. This chest includes the Shrieking Razorback Courier, the Infernus Invoker Forge Spirits, the Ravenous Forestling Nature's Prophet Treants, the Barbed Crawlers for Broodmother Spiders, and a Frostborn Sigil for Tuskar. So that's a nice, interesting twist. Some new custom little effects for a lot of, you know, some people's favorite heroes, I guess. So that's a neat little niche thing. So, I mean, what do you think, guys? This is probably going to help a lot for the ticket sales and for
If you look at the pool right now or whatever, they've only made like $11,000 additional prize pool, which is pretty garbage, honestly. Like
it's a little concerning, honestly.
You know, other tournaments. I mean, Starladder, I don't think it's a valid comparison because Starladder is sort of like the top. You know, they get the more ticket sales than anyone, but only 11K is pretty bad, and that does kind of show you like how many people buy the thing for the item. So this is kind of an interesting way for them to capture that information directly because no one kind of has before. And I know Kennegat decently well, and he's a smart guy, and they just wanted to try something different and see what actually happens. I don't know. I mean, I think it's an interesting strategy. I don't know if it's.
I do worry a little bit. There's a risk in it. I mean,
the thing is that they're presumably losing money when they do this.
Because these item
creators take an enormous percentage of these sales. Presumably they're losing money from that, you know?
Sure. I mean, I think they're not as worried about that just because of the nature of the tournament, because they are concentrating more on the on-site revenue. The thing I was going to say about it is you do get a little bit concerned because it was a bit unfortunate what the TI4 compendium did to the Frankfurt sales. And over time, you do have to worry about your brand because there's no question to me. The tiny set's fine. The games have been great. Certainly, there's a lot of value in that Starladder ticket. But at this point, you got to think a lot of people that are buying the Starladder ticket are buying that brand. And
there's also a million more games in Starladder.
You've also got to worry, though, when you have these kind of lackluster ticket sales for two very high-profile major events, you worry what it does to your brand, right? Whether you're going to be able to, because you do eventually want to be able to hold tournaments. That have a heavy online component as well and want to be able to sell tickets. So I do think it's important that they raise some revenue here, that they visibly raise some revenue through the client.
I think the client is a pretty crucial component for
it really is for
tournaments. Like, it's a good opportunity. Valve might take a massive percentage, but it's still a good opportunity for people to make money in places that they wouldn't before. So, I mean, I definitely agree with what you're saying, and I give more shits about like the business side of Dota than a lot of people do. So I pay very close attention to this stuff. So I'll be interested to see what happens to their ticket sales now.
Yep.
Or their prize.
It can only get better for them. I think the items look great and I think they'll sell pretty well. So props to them because it's a big event in a huge city of New York. And I'm sure it's going to be costing them a pretty penny just to even have the tournament there. Of course, that's going to be happening at the Madison Square Garden Theater area. As far as the tournament goes, though, American qualifiers, 2/3 of the American LAN finalists have been confirmed with EG and Navi US. Props to Korok and Fogged, who are in the chat right now, taking the first two slots. All their teams still have a chance, though, through the loser's bracket to go for that last and final slot.
Rest in peace, Team Gerg. They lost.
Condolences. I'm real sorry. We wanted to anxiously see those KOTLGuy faces and on the jerseys. It's not going to happen. The dream could still be alive in other
tournaments. I might buy some jerseys anyway.
Yeah, I would.
I've been playing with the
idea. Sign me up. I'll be first in line to get all of that.
There are some very very serious requests about wanting the jerseys, so maybe I'll make like a 25 shirt Teespring or something.
Ooh, all right. I like that.
We'll
I like
see.
That.
Although everyone has been asking for them, so maybe I'll make them in some capacity. I don't know.
See, we'll sport them maybe on a future podcast episode.
I know Monolith wants one that says Gurgleth, so you know I'd pay to see that personally.
The names on the back top of the shirt, all like sort of Gurg puns.
Gurgleth, Gurgdago, Gurgdiz,
Gurgguy,
Gurgman.redbull.
I don't know how I would make my name Gurg. It sucks.
Gurg nipples. I don't know.
Gurg nipples.
Gurg nips. Gurg nips. Oh, Gurgnips. Easy.
Great.
European qualifiers of that ESL 1 tournament, Cloud9 are the first of four European teams to qualify for the LAN. The second team to qualify is the Secret Team. For two slots are still available, and that's between Power Rangers, XGameKZ, Virtus Pro, Alliance, and Na'Vi can still claim those two slots. Next up, as far as tournaments go, the Summit Part 2. The Summit 2 European pre-qualifiers. Eight teams were selected into the pre-qualifiers to determine who they will be playing in the first round. The top two teams from the bracket will earn themselves a spot in the main online part of the event. This is not the LAN. More details to be announced later in the week, like the main online part, invited teams, and etc. So more details to come as far as this tournament goes, even with the American division stuff. These are details that have not been officially announced but are to come. First round matchups seeded to be are going to be the XGameKZ versus Compass Gaming, Meet Your Makers versus Denial, BBC versus MYM, and Hellrisers versus Team Coast. There will also be an American Peak qualifier at some point. I already just said that, blah, blah, blah. So Summit 2, go ahead.
The other thing I just want to tack onto this that's probably not public. I mean, I think it's like publicly assumed or maybe, but EG, since they won the last one, do get a direct invite to the LAN finals. So they skip all of this. They go right to the LAN finals. They're going no matter what. So that's just an addendum that I don't know if it's like published anywhere. It probably is, but for people who are wondering if they're discluded from the groups and stuff, they are directly to the finals.
They will be directly invited back. There's a lot of great information and goodies to come, I'll tell you, for the Summit 2 to look out for. So real exciting stuff. They put on a great event last year, and I would only imagine that's going to get even better this year, so we'll see. And another thing Beyond the Summit have recently announced that they'll be taking on the Celebrity Deathmatch. This will be the first ARDM show match, a best of three for $1,000 between Team Tinker and the Hellraisers. This is going to happen on the 29th of September, so about 5 days from now, at about 2100 European time.
I guess. This is stupid.
It's fun. It's a novelty tournament. We were curious when we saw the mode come out if there would be a tournament for it. You know, it may seem silly and dumb and unprofessional, but there's going to be an audience for it regardless. I know I'm going to be curious, so I'm excited and looking forward to it because it's all about the RNG. It's going to be fun and novelty, so we'll see how it goes, and I'm looking forward to it.
Can you once in your life, Greg, just not shit on everything? Is that possible for you?
Tonight's been
pretty
okay.
He didn't shit on Dota Pit.
But this is just, I don't know. Whatever. I guess it's entertaining.
Yeah, I mean, I actually really... I like that BTS is willing to do things a little differently because... I mean, I don't necessarily want to see every tournament run like the Summit, but I think it's really cool. And I don't know. I feel like there are going to be so many more tournaments coming up in the next few months.
Tournaments are not a thing there's going to be a lack of.
That's right, BTS. And it is good for everybody to have some variety.
Absolutely. Agreed. And, you know, we'll see. There'll definitely be an audience there for it. You know, a nice little prize. Just one quick best of three. It's not going to be dragging on. It's not going to be overwhelming for, Beyond the Summit to have to take this on. It's just a one game or one series, rather, take it out and, you know, just quick viewer experience. That's going to be a lot of fun. So be sure to check that out. Once again, that's going to be happening on the 29th of September. Last tournament to talk about, MSI Beat It, the tournament, which has the ridiculous amount of qualifiers, probably the most I've ever seen.
Dude, I've completely lost track. But
if you don't know what it is, there is qualifiers for Europe, Middle Eastern, American, Chinese, African, Australian, C, and the APAC, which the only qualifier
APAC.
Left.
APAC, that's the only time I've seen that term used in Dota.
I mean, this is...
it is really weird.
That's so bizarre.
The most recent team to qualify was Arrow Gaming out of the C region, beating out Insidious Idol 3-1. And the other teams that have already qualified include Empire, Wired Gaming, Navi US, LGD C-Deck, and Bravado Emotion, which has got to be one of the most fantastic teams.
That's a great name.
Bravado Emotion.
The teams in this APAC qualifier are literally teams that I've never. Why didn't they just? I don't know. I don't know
what poker face, man. You got right.
Why didn't they just glump that in with the C qualifiers? Like,
yeah, it's pretty weird.
Jesus Christ.
I don't know. Yeah, that is kind of strange.
They're like Guardian Angels, Bet Boys. Like, these are teams that qualified for the like main thing.
I bet they're looking at our tournaments and are like, the Gurg squad. What the hell is that?
Okay, well, whoa, don't you shit on the Gurg, man.
I'm just saying they're probably looking over like ESL1. They get to have the Gurg squad.
I find it strange that they represent, and this isn't a slight.
APAC is just not a term that I'm used to seeing in the Dota community.
I mean, I think the strange thing is Middle Eastern more than anything. Really, I don't really when we talk about Dota and esports, we don't really think of Middle Eastern teams
That's
as
not
being
a thing that exists.
A big contender. I mean, at least with APAC, you have Korean teams there at very least. So
yeah,
same for Africa too. It's just like. Just maybe lump that all together, and you could have a pretty close in terms of the skill gap. You can get some decent representation there. I don't understand why there's the need to have these different regions. I guess that lumps in with the C and the APAC. So I'll agree with you there to a certain extent.
And the big question to me is how competitive are the finals actually?
They're not. They're going to be stupid. Right.
And that's because if you think back, I don't remember the name of the event. It was in France. It was like the World Esports Championship or something.
SWC.
Yeah. So like. Empire won the finals over EG, I believe. That was old EG.
And the rest of the teams there were all shit.
Right. Like, the tournament, I mean, there was actually one team, I think the French team there was Against All Authority or something, and they had a guy named Banz on Invoker who was just awesome on that hero, so I like them. But, yeah, otherwise, the tournament was pretty bad until the finals, and I worry a little bit. I shouldn't say too much because JD is doing that tournament, but I worry a little bit about the quality of play at the finals, but... You never know. I mean, the landscape is equalizing.
This is at some point we're going to talk about this. But when you say JD, you mean anyone that can get their hands on to cast anything? Like, that is a completely valid.
It's a land, but it is.
I don't know. Well, the land maybe will be. You know,
the land caps flying down it, and I think Zoe and Milk also are flying down to cast it. But yeah, that's part of the problem. That's part of the problem that the schedule just becomes stupid.
Fucking tournaments.
Well, how are you supposed to, though? Because the problem is...
Stop accepting so many tournaments!
But all the big tournaments... That's part of the problem is that all the big tournaments want JD or BTS, especially to do the lands. And
those people.
You end up with, like, 1,000 qualifiers that just kind of get farmed out on a... Yeah, who's free tonight basis. I mean, the organization is kind of crap. That's part of why... I did say earlier, I think it is time for some more mid-level studios, for some better organized... casting outside of, you know, let's have Toby and Cap and whoever they can find on Wednesday. I mean, look, and that's the thing they gave.
I mean, no offense to any of those people. That's not shots fired at the casters.
No, it's quite the opposite.
In BTS,
like Gorgon handled Gorgon the Wondercow handled most of the U.S. qualifier games. Cap stepped in and did a few. He was free unexpectedly, but he did a great job. It was just that. It was kind of all like, okay, can you do this? It's just the organization is a little bit haphazard. That's something I'd like to see cleaned up. But I mean, there are just so many games, and that's you know this now, Greg, that it is herding cats trying to get people to make plans and keep them.
Yeah. I don't know. Whatever.
You have to understand that
we're going to have an extended. We're going to have an extended rant about this. And I'm going to go off on like a million people, but
I'm ready, dude. I'm ready.
Well,
look who it is, folks. It's Mr. K-Pop Toast.
There's the man
with beer
and a beer
and dinner. Holy
dude.
Shit.
I'm so fucking what jealous right now.
What a Southern Belle.
That's pretty legit, dude. That's
pretty
legit.
How we know the cast is going on a little too long, boys.
Oh my God.
Thanks what a bro. See that we stat man, we're bros. Dude,
Brian is like Grace is the mother of the BTS house, but besides that, Brian is the mother.
What a life. Oh, and that is a Stone IPA beer. Fantastic stuff. Oh wow, I'm living the life right now. But gentlemen, we gotta push past this. We gotta get to the last section here. We got a small little bit to talk about. We got a little bit of drama. We got a little bit of fluff. All right. Just you know, we're getting tired of this bullshit. All right. The DDoSing, it's getting out of hand, and most players' tournaments have experienced way too much of it. And this week alone, we've seen a lot of games and teams trying to play 4v5. It's been getting absolutely ridiculous. The Navi versus Secret Team in ESL 1 year qualifiers was a nice example of this. I mean, what the hell's going on? Some people are thinking a good way to get around this is maybe changing from Skype. But, I mean, realistically, is that going to even happen here? I mean, come on.
Anyone who says, like, get off of Skype, you don't understand Skype is, like, the way. If Skype didn't exist, esports would not exist because everyone uses Skype for everything. And until there's an alternative that already has that network built in, people are not going to switch off it. I have like 500 contacts on Skype or something, like some absurd amount, because it's instant. Email is not instant. IRC is shit. Like, there's no good alternatives that, I mean, the voice part of Skype is definitely shit, but you can't just switch off of Skype. Like, it's not that easy. It's not like a flick of switch. Everyone moves to something else.
It's this generation's AOL instant messenger. It's pretty much what it is.
I mean, but my thing about this and my thing, you know, moving forward, DDoS is not like, I'm not going to accept DDoS in Dota Pit. DDoS is not going to be a thing that's going to be like, oh, you're DDoSed. Like,
and it was said.
We're going to delay.
Rule with an iron fist.
Like, if you're fucking getting DDoS, then you're done, dude. Like, you lost. Because yeah, there's a million ways to get around DDoS. Like,
incoming teams hiring DDoSers to quickly win the whole Dota Pit.
I mean, if you read the statement, the second statement that D2CL released about that, and again, you know, D2CL, there are some people that have issues with them, and this is not to say that they're perfect and wonderful in every way, but I did agree very much with the second statement that they released that basically said, look, you know, this is, you compare this to a sports team having to play with a star player injured or that had forgot some equipment, right? You kick the player, the player kicks himself, or the manager or the staff kick themselves and say, gee, we weren't prepared to play, and so as a result, we lose. And, you know, at some point, the people in the best position to stop DDoS are the players and teams. And I hate, absolutely hate, that players and teams have to be held responsible for a bunch of pimple-faced 13-year-olds with nothing better to do with their time but to fuck the rest of us.
Such stereotyper against DDoSers, Nahaz, I tell you what.
Seriously, these people can go to hell. It really pisses me off, but all that said, you got to deal with it somehow. And the only efficient way, the only way that makes economic sense I can think of is to expect the players and teams to find a solution. And that's exactly.
There are solutions.
There are solutions. And that's exactly, again, why I said earlier, it is very important that tournaments have clear rules. There needs to be policies on servers. There need to be policies on DDoS. These rules need to be up online for everybody to read and to see, and they need to be followed. And that's the other thing. Like Cyborg Matt earlier tweeted, and you know he's picking a little bit of a fight, but he tweeted earlier that, oh, in fact, if you read the D2CL rules, that the D2CL rules actually mandate, they can be read as mandating the use of Skype. And I understand that's kind of him, in my opinion, picking a fight, but he's got a point. These rules need to be online, visible for all to see. They need to be read, and they need to make fucking sense. I'm sorry.
And there's been guides already thrown up on how you can dodge and hide your IP. And
yeah.
You know, managers could pre-prep this with their team and make sure each of them go through the process and they can, you know, get their IPs hidden before they go into these big matchups and just prepare. It's unfortunate that they have to add this as far as the preparing for some of these matches, but it's becoming quickly clear with how popular these are, you know, these games are becoming, that it just might have to be another step.
The other thing is, like, anyone who's saying, like, just turn Skype off before your pro matches, like, that's not how it works. You get an IP address through Skype, and then you DDoS them when the match starts. And yep. You can't just, like, flip a switch and change your IP address. But there are long-term ways to fix this through proxies, through VPNs. You can just host Skype through, like, a proxy or something. There's a million ways to fix this. And if you do something simple, then, the chance of you getting – you can still get DDoS. It's not, like, you're DDoS-proof. But, you know, it's, like, you'll prevent 95% of getting DDoSed, the big thing.
There may be – look, and this, I don't want to make the issue sound trivial.
But okay? Have you known the people that are DDoSing you are not, like, 40-year-old lifetime computer hackers? They're, like, stupid 12-year-olds renting scripts from 4chan.
Right. That's the thing, okay? Eventually – we may hit the point where some of these online tournaments are big enough, and they may already be big enough, that we are going to have some serious players where some of these workarounds that we know about don't necessarily work. And it at that point, we may have to talk about some other measures and some other rules.
Agreed.
My sense is that we're not at that point.
No.
My sense is that most of the DDoS attacks that we're talking about here are preventable. And again, I don't want to sound like I'm ragging on players and teams, but we've got to hold somebody responsible. And unfortunately, in this case, the onus is going to fall on them.
Yep, absolutely. So with that said, guys, we have gone through quite the show. We knew this was going to be a long one. We had a lot of big events. The patch pretty much covered the majority of it, as we wanted to still tackle on a lot of the news. It's been a long one, about 2 hours now. But we definitely appreciate everyone who's been sticking in all the way through. And, you know, we finally are going to look to wrap things up here. This was TrueSight, episode number 5, our Dota podcast being presented by FountainDive.com. Go check out that website for all sorts of great Dota content. And, of course, all of our past VODs from previous episodes. I want to thank again Mr. Greg WhatIsHip, Travis Ma, and, of course, our special guest, Mr. Nahaz, for coming in on such a late notice and giving away. Gentlemen, before we go, we can go through each. Do you have any quick shouts we can go through? Greg, we'll start with you.
Condolences to Gurg Squad. Dude. Yeah, condolences to Gurg Squad. Follow me on Twitter at WhatIsHipTV and fuck LD. Yep,
of course, all those Twitters going to be right there on these fancy overlays provided by our fancy schmancy company at Fountain Dive. And of course, Sam, our excellent producer, providing all the great web overlays. And you can see what the hell we're talking about on the screen. This guy is a magician with what he does. Ma, any last shout outs for you?
Again, like last week, shout out to Kieran who does the he does the write up for us for the podcast. So you can follow him at MustWinFull on Twitter. That's at MustWinFull. And for me, that's it. Don't follow me anywhere, I guess, or something. I don't know. Whatever.
Yeah, just don't do it. Absolutely not. Nahaz, can't thank you enough, my man. Anything you want to say before we let you go?
Well, I do. I'll shout out one more time, as I've tried to do lately, to a lot of the folks at JD that work on a volunteer basis. There are a lot more of them than people think, and they never get thanked. So I do like to thank them whenever I can. To, of course, the people that are tuning in tonight, we really appreciate it. To the very crazy people, including that guy in the middle on my screen right now, who are like having me as a co-caster because I don't know if I'm any good at it, but it's actually really fun. So it's crazy.
You're doing a great job.
I have no idea why it's so fun, but it is really fun. So it's something I may do more of. And yeah, thanks guys for having me. This was actually a lot of fun. I am obviously an academic. I tend to ramble, but it's always fun talking with you guys.
Absolutely, and do appreciate it once again. And of course, from us on HighGround TV, you could see more action from us. Still, the Canada Cup Season 3 happening right now. We're into the playoffs. Look for more action to come. We got more happening tomorrow. Greg, do you know the time exactly? I believe it's happening around 7 to 8 p.m. Eastern time. There might be a bit of delays as teams have been double scheduled between two different events. I believe there's going to be Starladder America and the Navi US need to move over to do the Canada Cup with us. You can catch all that action over on twitch.tv/Dota2CanadaCup. Did I say that right? I hope so.
That's right.
I'm getting delirious by this point, but thank you so much for coming by. Be sure to follow this channel right now to find more action. We hope to come back to you next week with another fantastic TrueSight episode. Thanks again, folks. Take care. We'll see you on the next one.